Ladies and gentlemen, the Future Science Prize Week and the 2023 Future Science Prize Symposium will begin shortly. Please be seated. Please be reminded to change your mobile devices to silent mode or turn it off. Thank you for your cooperation. The Future Science Prize Week cannot make it without the support from different organizations. We are proud to present our event organizer, the Future Science Prize, and co-organizer, the Hong Kong Academy of Sciences. Our strategic partners, including Tencent Foundation, the University of Hong Kong, Sandu Group, and our designated hotel for scientists, Shangri-La Group, our exclusive airline, Cathay Pacific, and our partners including Byron Inc., City Capital, CPE, Future Innovation Fund, MSA Capital, Qiming Venture Partners, Sanofi, 186 Holding Group, 5Y Capital, and our supporters including JP Morgan, Prenatics, the Hong Kong Young Academy of Sciences, Aqualic Fund, and our funding organization, Innovation and Technology Commission, and our media partner, Radio Television Hong Kong. May I invite you all to give the big hands to our partners. Thank you so much for the support. Thank you.
科学的重要性是非常清楚了，没有科学的发展，世界不可能像今天这个样子。未来论坛创建这个科学大奖是一个非常有意义的事情，这是一个了不起的创举。
科学的作用最根本的就是扩展了我们人类对自然界的了解。科学是我们人类知识的边界，其实也是我们生存空间的一个开拓。
所以我们希望呢，这个科学啊，慢慢的成为我们现代社会的一个非常重要的一个文化，会对我们这个中华民族的兴起吧，会起一个非常重要的作用。
科学已经成了我生活中间一部分，而且是生活的一大部分。数学这种美比较，就是有一点阳春白雪的样子，比较抽象的美。和一种绝对的真理。
很多做科学的人，包括自己在内，是可以从小一直有兴趣，一直到现在，或者一直到将来。
我小时候的理想，就是因为有那个科学的春天，正好在我小学毕业的时候啊，理想就是要当科学家。现在回过头来想想，那时候真是一个很幸运的选择。
它是一种探索，是一种创新，这种探索会是孜孜不倦的，会是勇敢的，甚至有时候是这个寂寞的。
科学跟技术的发展呢，其实是带来人类的文明的发展。技术呢的发展呢，带来的呢是一个渐进性的发展，但是呢，科学的发展呢是一个根本性的基础性的发展。
我们用的 GPS 都用到广义相对论，都用到这个基本的一些物理原理，所有的一切都是用到科学。
中国最缺的就是那些核心技术，而中国核心技术的提升一定要靠我们中国基础科学的研究的提升。
真正的创新工作的话呢，实际上是制定标准，不是跟着别人标准做。
一个是对在过去二三十年当中中国在基础科研上面一些有原创性的有突破性的是一种充分的认可，这个也就是对将来我们接下来二三十年当中或者接下来几十年当中，我们现在一批年轻人就是需要鼓励他们去走原创的道路，鼓励他们去多做一些有突破性的工作。
科学是大国发展必不可少的重要的基础，所以像我们中国这样一个大国是不可能避开科学而成为真正的一个世界强国。
我们今天有很多企业家的楷模，但是我们今天需要更多科学家的楷模。作为一个这个投资人，我认为他必须有这样的一些远见，同时我认为也有点责任去贡献更多，不管从资金上面还是从资源上面去推动这样的一些这个科学前沿的发展。
在这个时间点，我们这里讲的这更彰显了科技改变人类生活的这个重要性，真正的能够认可那些默默无闻的对社会做出巨大贡献的科学家，可以提升对他们的认知认可，
同时吸引更多的企业家、社会各界人士关注和支持科学家们的工作，促进科学成果的应用转化。
未来科学大奖是来自民间的，将会是国家、政府奖励科学研究、科技创新的有力补充。民间资本的介入，能使中国对科研工作者的奖励更加多元化。
任何一个奖，它的灵魂就是评审，不光是公正，关键还是它的准确性、它的科学性。这个评选的过程中，要借助全世界的各种专家来一起来评审。
我们靠什么规则来达到最大限度的共识，是一个技术性的问题，跟规则的建立是有关系的。我们就是确保每次开会、每次讨论，我们整个规则是得到严格执行的。未来科学大奖能够在今后的多少年里，是越来越得到公众的认可，越来越得到科技界的认可，使得它能够发扬光大，最后变成全世界范围内的人类的共同财富。
我们今天呢，是在探索一条路，能够让企业家和科学家结合在一起，通过这种大奖的形式的话呢，给予科学家，给予中国的基础科学的研究呢，给予支持。
这样的这个做法呢，完全是自发的。我们确实觉得，一个国家的一个创新能力，对国家的这种繁荣昌盛太重要了。做未来科学大奖呢，也是希望在这方面做一些尝试，
推动中国的科学的这个发展与这个国力能够相称，使中国的这个整个整体的水平和竞争能力迈向一个新的台阶。
希望未来科学大奖能够成为国内乃至全球最具有影响力、最有激情、最好玩又最具有人文关怀的科学大奖，
成为华人对科学探知上一个里程碑的符号，能够让更加多的中国人通过这个大奖去热爱科学，
把这个科学的精神、对科学的了解、科学的热情传播到你的那个 community、 你的那个朋友圈里去。
我们的科学家人才也会层出不穷，我们的全社会的这个科学文化素养也会进一步的提升，
可以激励很多我们将来的青年学生来投身到科学当中。
这个奖项应该像血脉一样往下传，这个背后我觉得实际上是对一种科学精神一种启蒙、一种传承、一种强化。这样的话这个科学奖项就不是嘉奖的一个刹那，而是嘉奖的一个时代，甚至是若干个时代。
有一句话叫以史为宗，我却看着它100年以后的景象，100年以后未来科学大奖怎么样，那个时候人们会说诺贝尔奖不要不要，我们要未来科学大奖。
我预祝100年以后有一群中国科学家仔细看我们这个录像，然后回顾我们未来科学的大奖如何影响中国科学100年。
Gentlemen, welcome to the Future Science Prize Week and the 2023 Future Science Prize Symposium. It's my great honor to be the MC today. I'm Yo Yi Lan. Hello, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. Wow, we are so thrilled to be here with many great minds of the year. The Future Science Prize Week aims to promote scientific spirit and pay tribute to scientists.Leading the public to explore the forefront of world science with a forward-looking perspective. This year, our program committee sets the agenda and invites local and international speakers to ensure the high level of academic content and extensive global perspective of the conference. And for this morning's section is about chemistry, focusing on from theory, AI, machine learning, to experimental realization.And I would like to introduce this section's convener. She is Professor Vivian Wigwa Yam. She is Philip Wong, Wilson Wong Professor in Chemistry and Energy and the Chair Professor of Chemistry, the University of Hong Kong, Academician, the Chinese Academy of Sciences, Foreign Associate, U.S. National Academy of Sciences, Foreign Member, Academia Europea, Fellow, the World Academy of Sciences, Founding Member, the Hong Kong Academy of Sciences. Now let's give a warm welcome to Professor Yam. May now invite Professor Yam. And before that, of course, we would like to have a welcome message from Yang Xuanming 先生. Let's give a big hand to Mr. Yang.
Distinguished guests and ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the second day of the 2023 Future Science Prize Week. In my capacity as the program co-chair, and I'm truly grateful to address such an esteemed gathering of scientists, scholars, and our science enthusiasts from across the world. Yesterday, on the inaugural day of a science symposium, we all had the privilege to look into the fascinating world of science and acquiring fresh perspectives on our mission to recognize and advance scientific excellence. Today, we continue our journey with three distinct sessions, each offering a unique perspective on the ever-evolving landscape of science. It is delighted that we have gathered an impressive list of a lineup of more than 10 renowned scientists who will deliver keynote speeches and engage in insightful panel discussions throughout the day. It is definitely worth looking forward to their knowledge and insights. Our first session, the chemistry session, we'll explore the journey from theory to practical realization with a particular emphasis on the role of artificial intelligence and the machine learning. The physical science session will enlighten us on the exciting world of quantum computing, shedding light on the vast possibilities. Finally, the mathematics session will provide us with a panoramic view of mathematics, spanning from theory to the diverse applications. I'm truly delighted to see that at the Future Science Week being hosted in Hong Kong for the first time. As a professor from Shenzhen, actually, I believe that such events hold immense potential and opportunities for us to bolster the scientific influence of the Great Bay Area. I hope the event will not only achieve the prospect of enhancing academic connectivity and collaborations with the Great Bay Area, but also contribute to the broader goal of making the Greater Bay Area as a global leader in science and innovation. I would like to take this opportunity to express my sincere gratitude to all the individuals and organizations from various sectors of society who have extended their strong support to the Future Science Prize Week. It is through your collective efforts that we can achieve great success. In closing, I would like to extend my best wishes for a very successful 2023 Future Science Week. I encourage each and every one of you to fully immerse yourself in the discussions and the events of today, and most importantly, to enjoy the journey of discovery that science offers us. May the knowledge shared and the connections forged here continue to inspire and drive progress in the world of science. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, Professor Yang Xuemin, our program committee co-chair. Thank you very much. And now let's move the time to invite Professor Yang to come to the stage. Professor Yang, please.
So good morning. And thank you very much, Professor Yang Xuemin, who is an academician of Chinese Academy of Sciences and Vice President of SUSTEC. So thank you very much. And he's also the laureate of Future Science Prize in Physical Sciences last year. So thank you. Good morning, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. So I'm Vivian Yam. It's my great honor to serve as the section chair to convene today's section and to see you all in Hong Kong. First, I would like to extend my sincere welcome and gratitude to all of you. And thanks to the kind presence and elaborate preparation of all our distinguished speakers, some have traveled afar to Hong Kong. A big warm welcome to all of you. And thanks also to the efforts of the organizers. Now, with the great lineup of speakers, I believe we will have a wonderful scientific section this morning in the area of chemistry. The topic of today's section is from theory, AI, machine learning, to experimental realization. Now, please allow me to introduce our five distinguished speakers before their speeches begin. The first speaker is Professor Michael Levitt from Stanford University. He is well known for his work on chemical biology, especially for the modeling of protein stability and molecular dynamics, and simulation of large-scale functional motion. He was awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2013 for the development of multi-scale models for complex chemical systems. Today, he will bring us a fascinating talk about computational biology applied globally. Next, we have Professor Sharon Hammerschiffer from Yale University, but she will be moving to Princeton University in early 2024. And she will give her speech titled Proton-Coupled Electron Transfer in Catalysis and Energy Conversion, which are critical for many important chemical and biological processes. She will share with us her PCET theory relevant to applications in catalysis, energy conversion, materials, and biology. Then we have Professor Donghui Jiang, academician of Chinese Academy of Sciences from Dalian Institute of Chemical Physics, the Chinese Academy of Sciences. And as we all know, water is essential to life on Earth. He will present a new potential energy function of water for accurate simulation of water clusters and bulk water, and to allow a better understanding of the origin of anonymous water properties. He will give a talk on first principles theory of water. The forthcoming on stage will be Professor Xin Xu from Department of Chemistry, Fudan University. He will give us his view towards accurate and efficient theoretical modeling of heterogeneous catalysis, since catalysis is extremely important as it produces fuels and chemicals, provides sustainable energy, and reduces pollution and waste. The last but not the least talk will be given by Professor Alain Esperu-Gusik from the University of Toronto. He's well known in his work for his work on AI, and he will share with us the evolution of AI for materials discovery, especially in the era of materials genomics and the growing field of self-driving laboratories. And he will discuss about artificial intelligence and automation for modern chemistry. So now it's time for our speakers to deliver their excellent speeches. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Yam, for your introduction. Please be seated. Now, I would like to introduce our first keynote speaker of this session, Professor Michael Levitt, Robert W. and Vivian K. Cahill Professor of Cancer Research and Professor by Courtesy of Computer Science, Stanford University, Nobel Prize laureate in Chemistry 2013. He's going to share about computational biology applied globally. Let's welcome Professor Levitt.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Professor Yang Wenwei. It's a great pleasure to be here. And I know the session is meant to be directed towards AI, but AI is just one aspect of computers. It's a very important aspect, an aspect that has completely changed my life in the last 10 months. But I think it's important also to realize that computational biology has played a big role in where we are in biology, chemistry, and computing. So basically, it all started with a multidisciplinary revolution in biology. I am multinational, but also multidisciplinary. And I think we need to find a way where the physics section doesn't give prizes to any physicists, and the biology section doesn't give any prizes to biologists. We need to start to give prizes to pairs of people in different fields. And I think this is something which really needs to happen. So basically, the revolution started in the early 50s in Cambridge, England. It was led by this man, Max Perutz. He, for me, is the real hero of structural biology. He was the person who invented the method of protein crystallography, the method which has resulted in teaching us the structure of hundreds of thousands of proteins to date. He had an assistant, John Kendrew, and John Kendrew actually solved the first structure of a protein because he chose an easier protein than Max Perutz. He chose myoglobin, which is only 1,500 atoms, where Perutz was working on human hemoglobin, a more biologically relevant protein, but is four times as big. And it's interesting here that this paper was published in Scientific American. Back in the early 60s and 50s, Scientific American was the only journal in the world that had color pictures. So if you solved something really important, like the structure of a protein, you wanted it in Scientific American before Nature. Coincidentally, that same Scientific American was available to teenage boys on bookstands around the world. So there was a real democratization of where good results came. My final hero of science is Francis Crick, probably the most well-known to you, who with Watson, at the age of 35, not Watson, but Crick, solved the structure of DNA and published probably the most famous paper in Nature. Now, what none of you know, probably, is that when Crick did this work, he was the PhD student of Max Perutz. Furthermore, the critical information to solve the structure of DNA was that X-ray diffraction picture on the top, and Max Perutz saw the picture from Dorothy Rosalind Franklin and showed it to Watson and Crick. In spite of all of this, the paper is not Watson, Crick, Perutz. It's just Watson, Crick, and Perutz isn't even thanked. Now, can you imagine any scientist today whose PhD student does something as important as this, not putting his name in the paper? And this is the tragedy of today's science. Scientists should get score for how many papers they don't put their name on for people working in their groups. Granting authorities should say, if you have more than your name on more than half the papers, we cut your grant. Doesn't happen. Perutz realized more than anybody that the future of science depends on young people having independence and responsibility. Now, I was very lucky, because what happened is I was born in South Africa, and when I was 16, I came to England. It was 1963, 4 days before Kennedy was assassinated, so I remember very clearly. And in South Africa at that time, there was no television. Britain had television, and I became addicted to television very, very quickly. I was watching everything. Fortunately, there was only one channel. And on that channel of television, John Kendrew had a program called The Thread of Life. It was basically an introduction to molecular biology. And you can see that the sessions, it started in January 1964, evolution inside the cell, proteins in one dimension, proteins in three dimensions, and so on. And I saw this poem, and I was completely blown away to see that biology was really physics. I did a BS degree in physics at King's College in London. It was easier than going to Cambridge. And after that, I wanted to go to Cambridge to do a PhD with Kendrew. Kendrew said no. I was lucky that I had friends who were in business school. And they said, in business, if somebody says no, you never say okay. You always have a counteroffer. You never accept no. So my counteroffer was to Kendrew, if I can't come this year, I'll come next year. Anyway, it was a long story. In the end, Kendrew said I could do my PhD in Cambridge, provided I took a gap year and spent the gap year in Israel with a man called Shneur Lifson. So I was very young at the time, and as a result of doing this gap year and working with Lifson, shown there on the right, and his student Arya Varshall, who also won the Nobel Prize with me, was working at that time on understanding the energy of interaction of small molecules. And basically, Kendrew, unbeknownst to me, realized that if I worked on small molecules and was exposed to big molecules like myoglobin and lysozyme that were known at the time, I would put one and one together and maybe get two and realize that big molecules are just a collection of small groups and the same energy functions should work for them both. Anyway, we did some work on protein folding a bit later with Arya Varshall and also on enzyme reactions. And together, these three things were what they called multi-scale modeling of complex chemical systems. And this was what got me the Swedish medal, as we call it. Okay, let me just jump forward 40 years to work that we're currently doing on how does the ribosome work. So the ribosome, for those of you who are not biologists, is the 3D printer of the cell. It takes the information and makes the shapes. It does this by taking the sequence of DNA, reading it off in a code of every three base pairs, making a string of amino acids, and this string then spontaneously folds up to give a precise shape, which I tell people is maybe 1 nanometer across. So this is more precise than any printed circuit by a factor of 100. These biological machines are incredibly tiny, incredibly precise, and very important. So the ribosome is a big structure. It consists of about 1,100 residues, probably between 100 and 200,000 atoms, if you include the protons or not. And the question is how does it do what it does? Now, what it does is shown here. This is a picture of sort of the machinery of life. The DNA on the top makes a copy into RNA. The RNA is then read by the ribosome, shown here in the middle, and then the ribosome translates the sequence of RNA into a sequence of protein. And here's a cartoon just showing how we think the ribosome might work. There's the sequence along the bottom of the screen. A transfer RNA brings in an amino acid. If it doesn't fit, and it's not going to fit, it's kicked out again. Now one comes in that can fit, and then the amino acid, that blue dot, joins the chain. And now we've increased the length of the chain, reading something. This is done by a machine which exists in all living organisms. All bacteria, all higher organisms, all use the same machine. So what does the machine actually look like? So we took about 300 or 400 different structures of the ribosome. And it's like having different movies, different snapshots, but no movie. We arranged them into a certain order so that if we actually just went from one frame to the next, we would see the movement of the ribosome as it does this chemical reaction. And the movement is actually kind of sort of obvious. Basically, the ribosome has a headpiece shown here, the part that's rotating. And shown in larger here, essentially the headpiece rotates and moves the tRNA forward, and it goes back, and another tRNA comes in, it rotates. You could actually make a model of this with rope and wood. It is very, very simple. But actually, it was not easy to find the simplicity. And one of the really hard things about science, and I think something that's going to worry us quite a lot for AI, is trying to find the simplicity. And simplicity, finding simplicity is actually one of the hardest things to do. It shouldn't be too simple, it shouldn't be too complicated, and somewhere in between is the right balance. So we're still working on this, and this is actually a picture from quite a long time ago, I think 2017. And then unfortunately, in January 2020, certainly my science was interrupted. I have quite strong connections in China because my wife is a curator of Chinese contemporary art. She was a teacher in Beijing for 5 years, and she loves being in China. So basically, we were in Israel when we heard about the first corona outbreak, and she sent a message, just a message of we're with you, we feel for you, to her friends on WeChat. And the response was amazing. And it made me realize that people are actually very, very worried. So I decided to look at the numbers. Looking at numbers, data analysis is really important. Everyone today is talking about big data, but sometimes small data is really important. So basically, I got involved with Corona, and essentially, I've been obsessed by it since. I'm slowly getting back to ribosomes and computational biology, but it's in session. So it's crisis science. Now, crisis science is very, very difficult. All the actions of governments and whatever have to balance costs and benefits. Everything you do has a cost, everything you do has a benefit. And the only way you can balance costs and benefits if you can evaluate them some way. What is the cost of doing this? What is the cost of not doing things? We need to estimate the costs. We need to understand as much as possible how things will evolve in time. So if we have a prediction of what's going to happen in a week's time, and it's 10 times worse, we're really worried. If it's 10 times better, we maybe feel more peaceful. Need to compare with situations that we already know. We need to do real-time research in real time, which will be full of typos, full of errors, and try to learn from mistakes. And we have to have a global outlook because we have to learn from all countries. So basically, I was involved from the very start. At the end of January 2020, I started to analyze the numbers. And on the 1st or 2nd of February, I published my first report on COVID in China. And the table is all the data there was. I think there's data there for 10 days, and each day we have 4 numbers. So essentially, this is small data, 40 numbers. But actually, 40 numbers can be very helpful if looked at with love and care, I suppose. And we looked at various obvious things. The top curve is how many cases since the first day, and so on. But there was one thing we looked at, which again is obvious, but surprisingly wasn't looked at. So everyone knows that viruses grow exponentially. What exponential means is that the growth rate every day is the same. And let's imagine it is 10% a day. So if you have 100 on the first day, you'll have 110 on the next day, and 121 on the day after, and so on. Now, this could be your bank. It could be a bank paying interest. And if the bank pays interest, the same interest rate, you expect to get 10% a day. Now, for viruses, you don't really want the 10%. For money, you do. Now, it turns out that one way you can measure the interest is to take the amount you got today and divide it by the amount you got yesterday, and it should be 10% more. So this number shown here is what I called the fractional death change by day, which is the total number of deaths today divided by the total number of deaths yesterday. If it was exponential growth, it should increase by the same amount. In other words, that curve should be a flat horizontal line. It starts out at a 50% growth, but it very quickly drops to 25% growth a day, and then 12% growth a day, and so on. So it's a little bit like a bank who tries to attract customers by saying, the first day you put your money in, you're going to get 100%. And the next day, 50%, and the next day, 25%. And you'll discover it would have been much better to have 2% for the whole year than something like this. So basically, it looked from this early information that the virus growth was slowing down. Unfortunately, or perhaps fortunately, I sent this report, just as you see it here in English, as a PDF file to my friends on WeChat and WhatsApp and email, and somebody, I don't even know whom, had it translated into Chinese and posted it in Weibo. And within a day, it had been seen by 2 million people. It turned out it was a day I was actually flying from Israel to New York City, and when I landed, everyone said, I got all these emails saying, are you the Michael Levitt who wrote this report? And I said, yeah, I wrote a report for my friends, and then I discovered this, and I felt I had an obligation to continue my work. And basically, I did, and you can see the same trend of coming down is seen here. We now know this is something very intrinsic. So basically, there are basically two broad categories of growth functions. One is exponential growth, where you grow exponentially until you exhaust something, and then you stop growing exponentially. And that is actually shown in what's called logistics growth, where the growth rate is constant, and then when you start to saturate, goes down. There's a very different kind of growth function, which was actually discovered by a British scientist and published in 1825, almost 200 years ago, a man called Gompertz. And in this function, the growth rate is actually decreasing exponentially, just like the bank, 100% the first day, 50% the next day, and so on. And with the Gompertz function, from the very beginning, this blue line is showing what the growth rate is. Anyway, so this, now the big difference between Gompertz growth and exponential growth is that compared to Gompertz growth, exponential growth is really, really slow. Doubling might sound very fast, but if you need to go from 1 to 1,000 in 10 doublings, Gompertz goes from 1 to 1,000 in a third of the time. It shoots up really quickly, but it's slowing down. It's a very different behavior. If you like, people think exponential is fast, but exponential is slow and steady. Gompertz is super fast and slowing down. Okay. Now, at this point, I teamed up with a colleague, actually an Italian scientist at Shanghai Technical University, and we wrote a paper on trying to understand whether real growth of epidemics is Gompertz or logistic. And this just shows that the trick for Gompertz growth is the contact network of people. If people are contacting, each person contacts the same number of people, then you have exponential growth. If each person contacts a random number of people, you have exponential growth. But if the contact network is scale-free, you get Gompertz growth. Now, what is a scale-free network? It's a network where there's a long tail, and there are quite a lot of people who have many, many contacts. And we all know that in social networks, some people have a million contacts, but the average person has 10 contacts. The same thing is true of many networks. So if the infection contact network is scale-free, you get Gompertz growth. Basically, in Gompertz growth, the reproduction number, which epidemiologists use all the time, is not 2 at the beginning, it's 100 in the beginning. This shows in blue, the real epidemiological reproduction rate in New York State and in Italy, Lombardy, it starts at 100, but it's dropping exponentially. So basically, the reproduction number is just like the interest rate at the bank. It's more complicated, it's averaged over a period, but it's that number. So basically, the data, the raw data, tells you that in the beginning, a person infects many, many more people than later on. It's never exponential, it's decreasing all the time. This just shows a video of simulation. The red are infected points, and some points have many neighbors, and some points have few neighbors in a scale-free way. And this is the exponential growth rate, and it's decreasing linearly. And slowly you can see how it spreads very quickly. In the beginning, the rate of spread is truly terrifying. This is why Italy had the incredible shock that it did, why New York had the shock that it did, and why China could not control. Once it started, it was uncontrollable because it's growing by Gompertz. But that's the bad news. The good news is it stopped in 6 weeks. Okay, so they basically grow because some people have many, many contacts, but most people have very few contacts. The people with many contacts get infected very quickly because they meet many people, but they also infect very many people. But once they're infected, they're no longer contagious, so it's all fine. Okay, so let me just move to something different just for the last 5 minutes or so. and that is climate change and crisis management. I think we are going to have to learn a science of crisis management. The scientific community is extremely bad at accepting new ideas. We are conservative. It's good to be conservative, but we need to realize that we cannot have groupthink. And unfortunately, during the COVID pandemic, scientists did everything they could to stop ideas that weren't in their little box. And unfortunately, if we do that, we're in big, big trouble. For me, I actually, a book I love, and this is an aside, is The Three-Body Problem by Liu Cixin. And in that book, humankind has to think out of the box to escape the censorship placed on Earth by extraterrestrial forces. Censorship, we have to think out of the box all the time, and scientists self-censored. Okay, so global warming is a complex problem. It involves the Earth, people, and countries. The whole planet's health, individual companies' economic health, and human health. And we need to learn not to deal with the long-term trend, but to deal with crises. One of the consequences of a change in temperature of only 1.5 degrees, shown here in the green curve going to the pink curve, and all of this data is done old, it's old data up to 2010, what happens if the bell-shaped curve shifts is that rare phenomena become very common. What used to be 1 in 10 is now 1 in 4. What used to be 1 in 1,000 is 1 in 17. This is just shifting two Gaussian curves and looking at the increase in area at the extreme. There's nothing clever here. So, and these events cannot be predicted. They're stochastic. They're random fluctuations. These are the high-end fluctuations. So we need to learn about how to minimize damage caused by heat waves, by droughts, by floods, by fires. We need to learn from all of them, and we also need to think of these learning experiences as experiments. Learning means being flexible. Learning also means to know what is the cost of treatments versus benefits. So we need numbers to measure health and well-being. There are lots of numbers for the health of the Earth. There are all these satellites telling us all these things. There's even more numbers for economic health. We know the economic health of a country instantaneously. Surprisingly, there is a huge lack of information about human well-being. If I had to point a finger, I would say this is a colossal failure of the World Health Organization, and you'll see what I mean. So just saying what I said before, we need good numerical data about Earth, wealth, and health. We have Earth satellites, we have economic data, but we do not know enough about human health. And we need to know about disease prevalence, life expectancy. Life expectancy is a terrible number. The reason is it assumes, life expectancy says we have a certain mortality this year. If it continues for the next 80 years, what will be the life expectancy? Anyone who assumes that our number today will continue for 80 years is crazy. So the life expectancy of the United States just went down. It assumes we're going to have COVID for the next 80 years, the way the numbers work. But there is a good number, and that's excess death. Death is not maybe the nicest thing to measure, but it's way easier to measure death than population health or number of heart attacks. It's something which is pretty clear. Either you're dead or you're alive. And it's possible to take data from earlier years and ask, are the number of people dying in a certain week, a certain month, a certain location, more or less than what you'd expect? So this is called excess death, which is basically the actual death minus the expected. I have to correct that error. And if the excess death is high, something is wrong. This could be a heat wave. It could be to say, in Shanghai in the summer, there are normally this number of deaths. Last summer, we had a high temperature. How much were the number of deaths affected? A very important number. Okay. So basically, we have a paper, and I should point out to you that my approach to go into this field really required a Nobel Prize as armor. People were shooting at me all the time. I didn't care. I felt that scientific truth was more important than anything. But if I had been in a less strong position, I would have lost my job. Fortunately, as a result of this work, much was done on Twitter and other places. I met a really renowned epidemiologist, a man called John Ioannidis, a Greek scientist. He has 500,000 citations. I have never met anybody else who has 500,000 citations. And he's actually still, he's 55 years old or something like that. So it's amazing. This is a paper where we were comparing excess death during the years of the pandemic over different countries. And basically what you find is that some countries actually had a debt deficit. That means they had less deaths than they would expect during the pandemic. New Zealand, South Korea, Iceland, Australia, Norway, Denmark, Sweden, all had less deaths during the pandemic than for normal years. Why? Very easy. During the pandemic, for reasons we still don't understand, flu disappeared. There was no flu in the world. Flu kills people. If flu disappears, people survive. And you can actually tell from the numbers that in South Korea and New Zealand, about 5% less deaths per year by not having flu. That gives you a good estimate of the real cost of flu. It's very difficult to get that number because we don't do PCR testing for flu normally. Other countries are much worse off. The top one is Poland, United States, Slovakia, Czechia, Lithuania. Italy, which we all heard a lot about, is in the green band at 8%, Netherlands at 5%, and so on. So basically, you see that there are countries that have negative excess death, better than normal, and countries that have a lot of excess death. Just look at this more closely. It's interesting to compare the United States and Europe. You can make a Europe by adding together different countries that's about the same size as the United States. In fact, Europe, I think, was higher population, maybe 500,000,000 people. United States, 3.3 billion people. Basically, what you find is, you know, the excess death goes up and down during the outbreaks. Well, COVID is killing people. There's no doubt about that. In pink, I show the excess death of people over 65. Most of the deaths are people over 65. In Europe, you can see on the right that there are very few excess deaths under 65. The green line is essentially over the dotted baseline. For the over people, there are peaks where the red line is over the dashed red line. And basically, in Europe, about 13% were under 65. In the USA, it is much worse. I forgot to fill that number in there. It's 400,000. So the excess death of young people in the United States is four times higher than in Europe. This was published. Another paper was published on this. And one thing I should say is we have a paper, I hope, coming out in PNAS, if they haven't censored me again. And I hope they won't this time. It's got through the reviewers, and now the editorial board could censor me, but I will fight back like crazy. Basically showing that this picture can be reproduced quite simply. What measure of a country indicates its excess death? And no big surprise, it's the level of poverty. High poverty, high excess death. Low poverty, little excess death. And this is why, very sadly, if you read off the top ones, it's countries that are not really comparable to the United States, like Poland, United States, Slovakia, Czechia, Lithuania, Chile, Croatia, Latvia, Hungary, Slovenia. Those are the top 10 on that list. So Europe, the United States, in terms of COVID, is like Eastern Europe. It's not like Western Europe. It's also that way in terms of poverty. So I think it makes sense, but it also means that the way you stop, you get resilience to crises, is worrying about everybody. Poverty is not a good thing, even if you don't care about poor people. It's not a good thing because it weakens your country's resilience against crises. Okay, so I just wanted to end by saying that in science, the truth always wins. This is something that Max Brutz has told us. Let me just tell you one other thing. I cannot give this talk at Stanford right now. Can you believe that? Anyway, thank you all for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Lippitz. Thank you for the insightful sharing. Please be seated. For the next keynote speaker, let me introduce Professor Sharon Hemischiffer, serving professor of chemistry, Yale University, member of the National Academy of Sciences. She is going to talk about proton-coupled electron transfer in catalysis and energy conversion. Let's give the big hands to Professor Schiffer.
It's a great honor to be speaking here, and I want to thank Professor Vivian Yam for inviting me to participate in this wonderful event. So I am going to talk about proton-coupled electron transfer, and I want to start out by defining what it is. Okay? So the electron and the proton could transfer between different donors and acceptors, as shown here, or it could be the same donor and acceptor. They could transfer in the same direction as shown here, or it could be different directions. It could be orthogonal. It could be completely opposite directions. The mechanism could be sequential with a thermodynamic stable intermediate, or it could be concerted with no stable intermediate. And it could also involve multiple electrons and multiple protons. So all of this falls under the broad umbrella of PCET. So you see, the only thing we need is at least one electron and one proton transferring. And all of these different options fall under this label of PCET. Now, PCET is important throughout biology and chemistry, right? In many biological processes, for example, photosynthesis, respiration, many different enzyme reactions. It's also important in chemical processes relevant to fuel cells, solar cells, and other energy devices. And we can see on this slide here, we see photosynthesis. We see the enzyme ribonucleotide reductase, which is essential for DNA synthesis in all living organisms. And down here, we see a dye-sensitized photoelectrochemical cell. In all of these cases, you see electrons and protons transferring in different places in different directions. So clearly, the transfer of these electrons and protons, however they're going in sequential, concerted, the same direction, opposite directions, it's all over the place in biology and chemistry. So we really need to understand this and need to understand how to control this. So over the past 25 years or so, my group has developed a general theory for PCET, where we include the quantum mechanical effects of the electrons and the transferring protons and the coupling and the varying timescales among the electrons, the protons, the donor-acceptor modes. By that I mean the proton, donor, and acceptor atoms can vibrate relative to each other. The solvent environment, if it's in a protein, then the protein environment as well. So all of these are moving on different timescales. We need to include all of this in a complete picture, a complete theoretical formulation. And we've applied this theory to a wide range of different systems. So up there in the left, you see an enzyme. And what's interesting about that enzyme is there's experimental evidence that hydrogen tunneling is crucial in this enzyme. Next to that, you see a proton wire, where when we remove one electron, we can get multiple protons to transport over long distances. This is important, for example, in energy conversion devices, where you need to transport protons across a membrane to get a proton gradient. Next comes the example of CH bond activation. That's important in many different organic reactions. And PCET occurs in nanoparticles. So nanoparticles have biomedical applications and many different technological applications, and PCET is there as well. And down in the bottom left, we have electrochemical PCET. So this first one is proton discharge onto a gold surface, forming a gold hydrogen bond. That's an important step for hydrogen evolution reaction. So how to create hydrogen, where we can store energy. The one next to that is a molecular catalyst on a graphite surface. Those catalysts can catalyze all sorts of different reactions, oxygen evolution, oxygen reduction, and so on, that are important for, again, energy science. And then we have a bluff photoreceptor. These sorts of photoreceptors have importance in sensing and also in optogenetics, which is an entire field now. And finally, the last one in the corner, that's ribonucleotide reductase, which we've seen, which I showed in the previous slide. That has six PCET reactions spanning more than 32 angstroms, and that's a crucial enzyme for DNA synthesis. So these are just some examples of many, many, many situations where PCET is central to the process. So I don't have time to talk about all of these. I'm going to talk about the two enzyme reactions, a little bit of the proton wires, and then I'll talk about the bluff photoreceptor. But before I get there, I want to focus on some of the essential concepts, the physical principles underlying PCET. So I want to start out by talking about single electron and single proton transfer. So a single electron transfer, you can see on the far right there, It's just an electron transfer between two sites. In this case, it's between two irons. And then we have a reactant where the electron is on the donor and a product where the electron is on the acceptor. And according to Marcus' theory for electron transfer, the free energies are parabolas along a collective solvent coordinate. So we have a blue parabola for the reactant and a red parabola for the product. And the physical meaning of that collective solvent coordinate is shown down there. You can see when the electron is on its donor, the solvent organizes itself to point its dipoles to stabilize the electron on that side. When the electron transfers to the acceptor, the solvent reorganizes and stabilizes the electron on the other side. And it's that solvent reorganization that corresponds to moving from the blue minimum to the red minimum. Now, in a certain regime we'll call non-adiabatic, the rate constant is just the probability of getting to the crossing point of those two parabolas, that black circle there, times the probability of the electron tunneling at that crossing. So that's the essential physics going on with electron transfer. Now, single proton transfer, there's an example, a little movie over there, where a proton is transferring from an oxygen to a nitrogen. The same picture can hold, right? We have two states where the proton is on its donor or the proton is on its acceptor. So we still have a reactant and product. We can still draw the free energy curves as parabolas along a collective solvent coordinate. Now, you might think, wait a minute, a proton is much heavier, right? It's almost 2,000 times heavier than an electron, right? And everybody pretty much accepts electrons are light enough to tunnel, right? That's all of our electronics, everything that's going on in our phones and everywhere, right? Electrons are tunneling all over the place. We need to treat those quantum mechanically, all right? But what about the protons? And I'll say that the protons can also tunnel, and they should also be treated quantum mechanically. And if we use the same framework here, then we can say, again, in this non-adiabatic regime, we can say that the rate constant is, again, the probability of reaching the crossing point, that black circle, times the probability, in this case, of the proton tunneling at the crossing point. Now, I just want to show an illustration of what I mean by proton tunneling here. So on the left here, you see a classical hydrogen, right? The proton's moving in a symmetric double well potential. And on the right, you see a quantum hydrogen. So starting with the classical one, if you just imagine these as train tracks, and you just drop a ball, that red ball, and it moves back and forth. And if you didn't give it enough energy to get over the barrier, it's never going to get over. So in the absence of friction, it's just going to keep going back and forth, and it will just stay in that well. That's the classical picture. Now, the quantum picture is shown over there. In the quantum picture, you're treating the proton as a wave function, right? And the square of that wave function tells us the probability of finding the proton in different coordinates. So first of all, we have zero-point energy. The proton will never get to the bottom of the well. That's why that wave function is shifted up relative to the minimum there. And second of all, if we just integrate the proton density, or the proton wave function in this case, by using the time-dependent Schrodinger equation, you can see that even though the energy is below the barrier height, that the proton can actually go from one well to the other. It can go back and forth, and it can basically tunnel, right? So it's actually not going over the barrier. It's going through the barrier in that case. So that's hydrogen tunneling. Now, this is just kind of a boring one-dimensional system, but this happens also in enzymes, for example. Here's an example of an enzyme. That green blob is the proton. It's in 3D now. And you'll see it starts to ooze along. It becomes, there it goes, it delocalizes, and it tunneled through the barrier. So that's proton tunneling in the enzyme dihydrofolate reductase. This is not some rare occurrence, not some esoteric concept. This is happening all of the time in chemistry and biology. This kind of proton tunneling event is very commonplace. So now we get to PCET. Right now we have an electron and a proton transferring, right? So instead of two states, we need four states. In the upper left, we have the electron and proton both on their donors. In the bottom right there, we have the electron and proton both on their acceptors. Then we have a one case where only the electron is transferred and one case where only the proton is transferred. So this allows us to describe sequential and concerted mechanisms. Sequential would correspond to going along the outside of the square. It could be ETPT or PTET. And concerted corresponds to going along the diagonal. We call that EPT. And the mechanism is determined by the relative energies and couplings among these four states, right? When the off-diagonal states are much higher in energy, the reaction will be concerted, will follow the diagonal to avoid those high energy states. So in that case, it turns out we still have a reactant where the electron is on the donor and a product where the electron is on the acceptor. All right, but now we actually have, instead of one-dimensional parabolas, we have two-dimensional paraboloids. So we have two collective solvent coordinates, one corresponding to proton transfer, one corresponding to electron transfer. Now, we all prefer to think in terms of one dimension, right? It's easier. So we'll just take a slice connecting the two minima of those parabolas, and we get, or the paraboloids, and we get the parabolas over on the right side of the screen, right, which we're more comfortable with. But you want to keep in mind we're treating that hydrogen nucleus quantum mechanically, right? We need to include hydrogen tunneling effects. So what's in those black dotted circles? Those are proton potentials, similar to what I showed before, that symmetric double well potential where you saw tunneling. Now it's an asymmetric double well potential. And I show also the proton vibrational wave function for the ground state. And you see for the reactant, which is shown in blue, the proton donor well is lower in energy and the proton is localized on that side. And the opposite is true for the product. Now the proton is localized on the other side. That's the red case there. Now, as we move along that collective solvent coordinate, we change the energies of those two states, and at that crossing point, it's degenerate, and this is where now both the electron and the proton will tunnel simultaneously. So that's the picture that comes out of this general theory. So we can look at it in movie form, where the electron and proton both start on their donors. Reorganization of the environment leads to the crossing point. At this point, the electron and the proton are both going to tunnel simultaneously from their donors to their acceptors, and further reorganization of the environment will stabilize the product state. So this is the picture that comes out of the PCET theory. These are concepts, right? Not complicated simulations. But then we derived rate constant expressions in different regimes. And it's just that thing in the rectangle, that square, I'm just going to say that's math. I'm not going to try to go through and define everything. We just did a lot of math and got rate constant expressions. But what's important, again, is more the concept. So now instead of just a pair of parabolas, we actually have two sets of parabolas, the stacked blue and red parabolas corresponding to the different proton vibrational states for each electronic state. But again, the physics is very similar to what I've been telling you about in the sense that the rate constant is still, for each pair of these parabolas, is the probability of reaching a crossing point. Now it's in an open black circle, times the probability now of tunneling, but it's electron and proton tunneling at that crossing point. So this is different, right? We've got to have two particles tunneling. And that I've labeled up there, I've labeled the overlap, that pink magenta color. That's the overlap between the reactant and product proton vibrational wave functions called S. Well, that overlap squared, it turns out, is the probability of hydrogen tunneling at that crossing point. That's actually a prefactor in the rate constant expression if you like math and you want to take a look at that. But what's crucial here is that we need to include, of course, the tunneling probability in our rate constant expression to understand how these processes work. Now, how are we going to get all the input quantities for that rate constant expression? Well, we can do atomic level simulations. So, for example, we can do quantum chemistry calculations, just the Schrodinger equation, H psi equals E psi. That gives us energies of different geometries. We can do molecular dynamics, just solve Newton's equations of motion, force equals mass times acceleration, right? Where we get the forces now from the potential energy. We can either do it with full quantum mechanics. We can do it with molecular mechanics, which is more of a functional form, or we can do it with a mixture, QMMM, right, where we treat the reactive region with quantum mechanics and the rest of it with molecular mechanics. And I could have a picture of Michael Levitt there, but I don't because you saw the real thing, right? And so why do we need a picture when we have the real thing here? So that's of course, what he is pioneered and got the Nobel Prize for, along with Karplus and Warshall. So we're standing on the shoulders of giants here. But we can do this not only to get the input quantities of our rate constant expressions, but we can also do it to understand how all the atoms are moving in the system, and we can understand mechanism. Okay, again, we want to really understand how things work. We don't just want numbers. We want to understand how they work. So with that, I'm going to get to some applications. So some examples. So this enzyme here, soybean lipoxygenase, catalyzes a PCET mechanism where an electron transfers from the pi backbone of the linoleic acid to the iron cofactor, and a proton transfers from the carbon to the oxygen of the OH ligand. We know this is concerted because single electron and single proton transfer are highly endo-ergic. They're uphill, whereas the concerted mechanism is downhill by about 6 kcals per mole. So it wants to go together. The electron and proton want to go together to avoid those high-energy intermediates. And of course, this is electrostatics. It makes sense that the two charges that attract each other want to go together. Now, what's interesting about the system is that Judith Klinman's group has measured the kinetic isotope effect. That's the ratio of the rate constant for hydrogen to deuterium. And they measured a value of 80 at room temperature for the wild-type enzyme and about 700 for a double mutant. So this is amazing. They replaced the one transferring hydrogen with deuterium, and the rate went down by 80 or 700. That's a huge effect, and that's a hallmark of hydrogen tunneling. So we wanted to explain that with our theory. I will say that Judith, when she first came out with this, there was a lot of skepticism. She had to fight very hard and to have a lot of courage. So this just shows you need to stand by your convictions and stand by your experiments, and they have, you know, now been reproduced many, many times. There's just suspicion that hydrogen tunneling could possibly be important in biology. But in our theory, it all comes down to that overlap, that S, the overlap that's now purple. That overlap squared, remember, is the probability of hydrogen tunneling. All right, now in this lipoxygenase system, the proton is transferring from a carbon to an oxygen. CHO is a weak hydrogen bond. All right, that means this overlap is going to be small. And it turns out with small overlap, you have a very large difference in the hydrogen and deuterium tunneling probabilities. You know that, of course, that overlap will be very different for hydrogen versus deuterium, but it's even more different the smaller the overlap is. So this is a very simple explanation for this result that led to so much controversy in the literature. Now, what about this double mutant? How do you get it from 80 to 700? Again, there was a lot of skepticism. Well, what we found when we did atomic level simulations, we found that the double mutant corresponds to changing those two leucines up there to alanines. Alanine is smaller, so when you do atomic level simulations, you see that the cavity expanded, so the substrate is rattling around more there, so it's not oriented as well, so the overlap is even smaller. And again, smaller overlap leads to a bigger difference in hydrogen and deuterium tunneling probabilities, and that's why the isotope effect gets so large. It's very sensitive to the distances and the orientation at that hydrogen bonding interface. A very simple explanation for experiments that were quite controversial. So now I want to get to another enzyme, ribonucleotide reductase, RNR. It's essential for DNA synthesis in all living organisms. It has a PCET pathway of six PCET reactions spanning 32 angstroms. You can see in this rectangle, starting on the left, you've got a tyrosine, you've got the radical on the tyrosine, it goes to the tryptophan, it goes to a tyrosine 356, which is at an interface. There's actually two subunits, so it goes from the beta to the alpha subunit across a water channel. So it goes to that other tyrosine, 731, which we think flips out to get the radical, and then it flips back to stack with another tyrosine, and it does some collinear PCET until it finally gets to a cysteine on the end. That radical on the cysteine is what then can do DNA synthesis. That can do the catalysis that we need to make our own DNA. Now, this is, of course, a dream come true for someone who loves PCET, right? There's all this PCET going on. But I didn't study it until very recently, because as a computational biologist or chemist, you really can't do anything without a structure. And there's no structure of this intact PCET pathway. But then Kathy Drennan and Joanne Stubbe, they published a cryo-EM structure of the entire intact PCET pathway back in 2020, and so we started working on it. And we're doing multi-scale simulations, because it's such a complicated reaction, right? We can't look at everything. And I'll just tell you a few little tidbits of what we did. We started out, we were interested in this tyrosine that we thought must flip out and back and forth, because in the cryo-EM structure, it's stacked with the other tyrosine. And in many of the crystal structures, it's stacked. So everybody just assumed it's stacked. There are all these biomimetic models out there for stacked tyrosines and looking at PCET, thinking they're mimicking RNR. But when we started doing molecular dynamic simulations, we found this tyrosine's flipping back and forth, as you can see in the little GIF over there, that it's going back and forth. And that makes sense, because it's got to get the radical from Y356 at the interface, and then it's got to flip back and give the radical to its neighbor when it stacks with it. So this is something that you can see from simulations that you can't see from a static structure. All right? Then we wanted to look at the PCET reaction between the two tyrosines, the two stacked tyrosines, 731 and 730. So we did QMMM free energy simulations. And like I said, this has been a model for many biomimetic systems. But when we did our simulations, we found that a glutamate came down and served as a proton relay, shepherding the proton from one tyrosine to the other. The experimentalists had no idea that glutamate was important. But when you did the simulations, it just moves right down and does that. And you can see this in this movie, that glutamate is just taking that hydrogen and helping to move it from one tyrosine to the other. So again, an example of how simulations can let the experimentalists know, hey, this glutamate is important. And when they mutate it, the whole enzyme dies. So we don't know, that's not that informative, but at least it does show that it is important. Now, that's just one of the PCET reactions. There are six of them. We've actually looked at four of these PCET reactions. But looking at all the individual ones doesn't tell the full story, because these six PCET reactions are all coupled to each other and they're coupled to the enzyme motion. So we really need to look at the whole picture. So in this case, this is what I mean by multi-scale modeling. We step back and we say, let's create a kinetic model. And so now each tyrosine or tryptophan or cysteine is just one circle in our model. And we even include both the stacked and the flipped Y731. And then we can get all the rate constants to connect all these with from simulations or from experiment. And then we can look at the full system here, right? We can look at the time evolution of radical transport all the way across from one tyrosine to the other. And we can even compare to some experiments where they inject a radical into the Y356 and watch it move along. Those experiments were done by Dan Nocera and Joanne Stubbe. So this is an example of how we can go from the atomic level simulation to the kinetic model, which gives you the big picture. Now this next example is bio-inspired by photosystem 2, which splits water into hydrogen and oxygen. This is a key step of photosynthesis, right? So in one of these steps, an electron is taken from a tyrosine and then a proton is transferred to a histidine. And we want to figure out, can we follow nature's example and assemble this kind of a proton wire where we use an electrode to take the electron and get one proton to transfer, or even make more protons transfer, 2, 3, 4. So we can transport protons the way it happens in bioenergetic systems. And this is a collaboration with Tom and Anna Moore, where they have been doing artificial photosynthetic systems, and they mimic this tyrosine-histidine pair with a BIP molecule, where when you remove an electron from this BIP molecule, you can get a proton to transfer from an oxygen to a nitrogen. And so we wanted to figure out, can we replace that hydrogen up there in the corner with something else that can get another proton to transfer and build a proton wire? And I'll say that we did. The computation helped to design these kinds of systems where we have 2, 3, and even 4 protons transferring. We simply remove an electron and we get all 4 protons to go, 16 angstroms. And again, this has implications for building solar energy devices and other types of energy conversion processes. And then the question is, are they really exactly going at the same time? Is it fully concerted? So from on the electrochemical timescale, it is. They never see anything other than all the protons on their donors or all of them on their acceptors. What if we then say, let's attach a photosensitizer and photochemically induce this reaction instead of electrochemically? So again, we can do theoretical calculations. We simply remove an electron and let it go. And what we find is it's not actually fully concerted. If you look on the femtosecond timescale, a very fast timescale, you can see the 2 protons are not transferring at exactly the same time. Okay, so that's on the first proton transfer happens about 100 femtoseconds after ET, and the second one goes about 600 femtoseconds later. And keeping in the vein of this photochemical PCET reaction, I want to talk about the BLUF photoreceptor. So in the BLUF stands for blue light using flavin. Right? What happens in these systems is that we shine blue light on this enzyme, that flavin goes to an excited electronic state. It causes a PCET reaction, which then causes conformational changes to occur, which then sends a signal 50 angstroms away, which can then turn on or off an effector. So it can cause a cellular response, for example. So this BLUF, coupled to an effector, can cause changes. It can cause neurons to fire, reactions to be catalyzed. And this is relevant to optogenetics, where light is used to manipulate cells and living tissue with very high spatial and temporal resolution. You can see this poor rat has something with BLUF in it embedded into its brain. So we did simulations of this to better understand it. These are again, QMMM. In this case, we need to do the simulations in an excited electronic state. Makes it a little bit harder, but we just basically put it in this excited electronic state and let it go. We see the electron transferring from the tyrosine to the flavin. We see a double proton transfer. We see a rotation of a glutamine, and then we see reverse PCET. And I'm going to show that movie now. There it is. So we photoexcite it, and then we see there's a double proton transfer. You see that glutamine there rotated around. And then we wait a little bit, and the protons are going to go back. And this is, again, information the experimentalists didn't have. They knew how it went in the forward direction. They did not know how it went in the reverse direction. So what we learn from this, and sort of it goes by kind of fast, so just to show the picture, we start in the dark adapted state, we photoexcite it, and then we have forward PCET, we have rotation of that glutamine, and then we have reverse PCET. And what's left there is what's called the light adapted state. This is the state that sends long-range signal, and it has a lifetime of 5 seconds, so that's very long on a biological timescale. It can stay a long time and send this signal. Right? And now from our simulations, we can just look at that, where we ended up after our trajectory, say that's the light adapted state. What's so special about it? And what we see is there's a hydrogen bond between glutamine, right, and the flavin. You can see that hydrogen bond on the far right there. And when we do some more calculations of spectroscopy, electronic absorption and vibrational spectroscopy, we see redshifts of the light adapted state relative to the dark adapted state that are consistent with experiments. So that's confirmation. But on the other hand, there's a lot of skepticism because this glutamine tautomer is very high energy. It doesn't tend to happen in biological systems. So, you know, there are many people saying impossible, we would never see this. But keep in mind, it started on this non-equilibrium photocycle. But another example of how actually one of the big critics, John Kennis, actually ended up then publishing a paper in JAX showing that indeed there is a rotated glutamine tautomer. So he even told me that yes, he is now a believer. And I'll say that it wasn't only us. I want to give, of course, other people credit for also proposing this kind of a rotated tautomer. So this is, I'm just trying to give examples of how theory is really helping to make predictions ahead of the experiments in some cases. We're not always following, and how we're providing new insights, right, and that could be tested and conceptual advances forward. And so I just want to mention that in these simulations, the hydrogen nuclei, all the nuclei are being treated classically, just Newton's equations of motion. But I told you at the beginning how important hydrogen tunneling is. So there seems to be a mismatch in how I'm thinking. How can I do these everything classically if hydrogen tunneling is important? So that leads to more developments. We always have to be developing. We're not just applying our methods, we're developing methods. And this is the nuclear electronic orbital, or NEO method, where we actually treat specified nuclei, usually protons, quantum mechanically on the same level as the electrons. And then we solved a mixed nuclear electronic Schrodinger equation. So we can now include the nuclear quantum effects and what we call non-born Oppenheimer effects. That means that the electrons are not assumed to be faster than the nuclei in all cases. But we include them in a very computationally efficient way. We have examples of water clusters, hydrogen tunneling and malonaldehyde, even solids with water. But what's most relevant here is photo-induced proton transfer, where that proton will be quantized. And that's what's shown on this movie here. We photo-excited this to an excited electronic state. That gray blob up there, that's the proton, but it's quantum mechanical now. And you can see it's not a point charge, it's oozing along. So we have to treat it quantum mechanically to get the full picture. The green and the blue is the change in the electronic density. And so we have no Born-Oppenheimer separation between the electrons and the protons. We're simply integrating the nuclear and the electronic dynamics on equal footing in a time-dependent framework. And so here we're doing photo-induced proton transfer. We can do the same thing for photo-induced PCET. Right? It basically, all the things I'm talking about, we can apply this method to look at those as well. So to conclude, I've told you how important PCET is, that it's really essential throughout chemistry and biology, right? And that we really have to treat both the electron and the proton quantum mechanically. They both tunnel, right? Not just one of them. And what I really want to emphasize is that it is the combination of analytical theories and atomic level simulations, right, that helps us interpret and understand experiments. And also the development of new theoretical methods, right, for PCET are continuing now. It's not done. These stories are not finished. A lot of these stories are still midway. We're still learning. And we need to keep developing methods like this NEO method. But that's not the only method. All sorts of groups are developing all sorts of exciting methods, how to quantize protons and look at nuclear electronic quantum dynamics. So it's a very active field. And it needs to continue to go. And I know that we are going to be talking a lot about AI and machine learning, and I haven't mentioned it yet here. And I will say that using that as a tool can be very useful for the kinds of simulations I'm talking about, these large atomic level simulations, for example. It definitely has a place in this area. But I don't think it's going to replace analytical theories, and I don't think it's going to replace thinking about the concepts and the underlying physical principles, which I've really tried to emphasize in my talk. And so I think it's very important to remember that, you know, thinking about what's going on mechanistically, understanding the concepts and the underlying physical principles, that's still always going to be important for understanding these types of chemical and biological systems. And then I want to, of course, acknowledge that many, many students and postdocs, not all of them are even shown here, but they worked very hard, our experimental collaborators, I mentioned all of them along the way. And I really want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you so much for insights, for sharing. Thank you very much. Please be seated. Wow, we did gain a lot of insights from this topic. And now we are going to have next keynote speaker, Professor Zhang Donghui, Steering Professor of Chemistry, Yale University, member of the National Academy of Sciences. He is going to share about first principles theory for water. Let's give big hands to Professor Zhang.
Thank you. Well, it's indeed a great honor and a pleasure for me to be here to join this special event. I would like to thank the Professor Yam for the kind invitation. So today I'm going to talk about the ongoing project, actually, that we have struggled for more than 5 years, actually. So we try to develop potential, the universal potential for water, right, from first principle theory. So, okay, the water is everywhere, right? We use a lot of water every day, okay? But actually, water is very strange, the substance. So the first one, we might realize, right, the water as density, right, is actually heavier than ice. But for vast majority of substance, right, actually the solid is heavier than the liquid. So this means, if this the normally, right, ice should be heavy than water. But actually, for water is very special, right? So we always know the water can float on the ice can float on water. But then, the even more strange, right? Actually, the density of water, right, is the highest at 4 degrees. Right, so this is very actually special, actually, also. So this means, no matter how cold is the weather, right, at the bottom of the lake, the temperature is 4 degrees, right, because the heaviest water is 4 degrees, right. So this is very special, right. But actually, much more than that, there are, 74, right, anomalous properties of water, there are very long list, right? So I just gave a few of them, okay? But anyway, trust me, they are water very special, and there are a lot of the anomalous properties, right? But then you may ask, why water is so special? Why so is the there are so many anomalous the properties, right? So obviously, it's depend on the structure of water, right? So what's the structure of water? Actually, these are very simple substance, right? We know, we use every day. But in fact, right, the structure of liquid water, right, actually, we still don't know, right? But, the stuff from the half century ago, the first model is called tetrahedral model, right? So this is just like ice, it's quite the simple model we can think about, right? But actually they found that that's not right. Okay, then later on someone proposed the rings and the chains model. Okay, then it's actually also not right. People found, right? So the latest model is disordered hydrogen bond model. Okay, so this is actually still going on. It's still ongoing debate, right? It's still not clear what's the final model, right? What's the final structure of the water? So that's why, it's the early this century, right? So the science gave rise to the 125 the questions. So one question is, what's the structure of water, actually? Hmm? So of course, we can use experiment. You say, well, don't we use experiment, right? But actually, it's very hard for water. For ice, it's very simple, right? So that is the solid, it's not moving, right? Or moving not, in large degree of freedom. But the water is, all the molecules move very fast in very large degree of freedom. So it's very hard to experiment to observe the structure exactly. So they can only provide some average information, right? So most well-known information is like the radio distribution function, RDF, right? So we very often see this kind of picture, right? But of course, if experiment cannot solve the problem, so the theory should take over, right? So for theory, if we want to the give the structure of the liquid water, right? We need a very good potential energy surface, we call the water potential, right? So if we have a good potential, right, which can predict all the property of water, from the exactly, right, or very close to experiment, right, from cluster to bulk to to ice to liquid water, right? Then we sure the model should be, or the potential should be very accurate, right? Then we can do a simulation. From a simulation, we can all the structure, right, of the water. So this is seems from what we have right now. This is maybe the only choice, right, we have. We should use theory, right, to solve this problem. So that's why, okay, the thanks first, okay, water simulation in the 1969, right? So it's just 2 years after I was born, right? So it's more than 50 years ago. Okay, so the, there are a lot of the potential or models has been developed, right? So this is the, okay, the left side, just a partial of the models, okay? Not all of them. But okay, the, but unfortunately, all of these models, right, including the, okay, the, this latest model, like TTM3, TTM4 model, right? So these are considered very expensive, very, very good, okay, polarized model. Okay, can only describe some of the water properties. So some of them can describe a cluster quite well, but not for the liquid water. Some of them can describe the ice, but not the liquid, okay. So can, once you can just describe, okay, the liquid quite well, the, but can, does not work for the ice. So this means a universal, the, okay, the water potential across the, all the phase, right, like from the cluster, from solid and from liquid, has not, does not exist. So why is it so hard? Because, okay, after 5 years, I gradually understand, right, the potential of a surface, right, the form of potential is so complicated. So it's, I think it's essentially impossible, right? You just imagine some formulations, or okay, try to describe, okay, the, exactly the force field or potential of the water. Okay, so the, that's okay. The machine, right? Machine learning gave us the chance, right? But because of the once the formulation or the okay form is too complicated, okay, we cannot imagine what kind of form we should use, right? So, but the machine learning doesn't matter, right? So once you, if you can provide sufficient data, right? So machine can give machine learning can give you very special, very complicated, okay, the potential surface, okay, from which maybe you can okay the simulate or what very accurately. So that's why, okay, that in the last, okay, the, like 10 years, right, there are a lot of work, okay, that is going on, right, try to use machine learning to develop the accurate potential surface for potential for water, right? So that basically there are two categories, right? One is, okay, the based on DFT, but another based on the cup cluster theory, okay, the high level of the cup cluster. But the, due to the, okay, the limited accuracy of DFT, right, later on I maybe show a transparency, right? So no matter how good, okay, the how good you learn, okay, you use your machine learning, right? But the, because DFT, the accuracy is limited, right? So you still cannot get accurate potential for water. But that, of course, the only choice maybe is, okay, that you should use high-level the cup cluster theory, right? But for cup cluster theory, there are also different approaches, right? So the due to limitation of time, I will not go to detail. So I feel, right, most feasible one is what we call the mini-body expansion, okay? So it's, in principle, we can just use very, very high-level theory, right, step-by-step, okay, under the help of machine learning, we can, okay, the eventually yield a very good potential surface for water. So what's a mini-body expansion? Okay, it's in principle, it's very simple, right? So you have, for example, you have N body, right? You have N water, okay? So you can always, okay, decompose the interaction into one body, two body, and three body, and four body, okay? These mini bodies, right? But if you are unlucky, right, you have to, okay, the, if you should go to very large terms, right, then this means that the convergence is very slow, you cannot use the theory, okay, anymore, right? But this, okay, I should mention, this is the mini body. This is what we call the mini body interaction energy. So this means like the two body, right? So we first calculate the two body total energy. We then subtract the single body, right? You have two water, right? You subtract the energy of two body, a single monomer, right? So this is what we call the two body interaction energy. If you have three bodies, right? So this means you first calculate the total energy of three body. Then you subtract the single body, three single bodies, right? Then the subtract two bodies, right? So the remaining part we call the three body. So this means that the part you cannot use to describe by using single and the double the two body interaction we call the three body. So four body is the same, right? So just you cannot use okay, one body, two body, three body. Okay, that part, right? The remaining part is we call the four body part. Okay. So we hope we can okay, truncate, right? We can stop somewhere. If we can go to 10 bodies, right? Then it's hopeless, right? But okay, it's quite lucky, right? About 10 years ago, right? Someone did a calculation on the like the water hexagon, the cluster. So for this the two clusters, they found, right? The okay, the on this side, okay, that if you use a couple cluster theory, right, you can calculate that, okay, one body, two body, three body, and four body, right? Once go to four, once up to four body, almost all the energy is there, right? The in the five body interaction energy is very, very small, is negligible, right? So we hope we can just stop at the four body, right? So we can get a very accurate result for the potential. So actually, there are some existing many body potential forms for water, right? So in particular, okay, last 2 years, okay, this last year and this year, right, we saw okay, two new form potentials, right, like Q aqua and another MB pore 2023, right. So the okay, all of them including the up to four body, right. But the problem is okay, there are two problems. Okay, you can see for body, they only use like less than 4,000 points, right, to describe four bodies. So four body in total is 12, okay, the atoms, right? In degree of freedom, there are 30 degree of freedom, okay? The 30 degree of freedom space, right? So it's very hard, very high space, right? So it's incredible for me, right, to use less than 4,000 points, right, to describe this four body interaction, actually. The first, I think it's even in for short range interaction, the potential part, right, the accuracy is very limited. Then to apply to the liquid water, right, for the bulk systems, they have to apply all this force field to combine with, okay, like the long range portion of this, the TTM force field, right? So this means they just only, okay, try to effectively, you can say, all these the existing mini body potential, right, for water only the effectively serving as a short range correction to TTM force field, right? So the large part of the potential is still depend on TTM force field. If TTM force field is good, okay, everything is good, okay, right? If TTM force field is not good, okay, everything is very bad, can be, right? So my question is, okay, is it possible to construct a high dimension potential surface, right? In theory, from first, it's global. Okay, you don't depend on TTM, right? So first, in theory, from the first principle, right, to accurately describe all the properties of water, right? So this is the very challenging task, right? But at the beginning, I don't realize it's that hard, actually. So after 5 years, I gradually, okay, understand this really very hard problem. So, very quickly, I'm going to tell you, okay, the methodology we use, right? So how to construct a high-dimensional potential surface, right? So what's potential surface? Okay, we do ab initio calculation very often, right? So for every day, not every day, very often, like a hydrogen molecule, right? So you can have, okay, so this is a potential curve, right? So we know very well. So if you do a ab initio calculation for like 10 points, right? You can connect these points together, right? To get a potential. So this is very straightforward, right? So this is for one dimensional. But in for high dimensional, like if you put, okay, 10 points for every degree of freedom or every dimension, right? For a system, okay, with the D degree of freedom. So you need the 10 of to power D point, power of D points, right? So this degree of freedom increase very fast. Like this is like a four body, right? Four water, there are 12 atoms, right? So in total, there are 30 degree of freedom. So every degree of freedom, you use 10 points. So this means you need 10 to power of 30, right? Points in this straightforward way. So that's impossible, right? We know. So over the past 20 years, there are many methods that have been developed, right? Called the PIP, right? Neural network, the PIP neural network, and the FINN method. So due to limit of time, the PIP method is developed by Bowman and co-worker, right? It's just used, okay, the PIP, they call the permutationally invariant polynomial to expand the potential surface. So this is the least square fitting method, right? But the accuracy not very high, it's about a kick up or more, okay? About 10 years ago, so we introduced, okay, to a neural network fitting method for the first time to molecular system, okay? There are some works, right? More than 20 years ago, okay? But somehow it's that we don't know how to add points, okay, during fitting procedure. So that's why it's very slow. So about 10 years ago, we figured out a systematic way, right, to construct the high dimension surface, okay? We first achieved, okay, a 2 mega EV accuracy for our four atom systems. Actually, then on, we a lot of people, okay, joined to this, neural network fitting, the procedure. So the problem for the original neural network problem is that we don't have the permutation symmetry, right? But for some, if we use molecular MD simulation, right, symmetry is very important to order, in order to make the force field continuous, actually. But then the Hua Guo University of Maxim introduced, they call them PIP neural network, just use PIP as input of the neural network to try to get retain the symmetry of the system. But the problem of PIP is that the number of polynomials increase very quickly with number of atoms. Okay, so they only can be applied to a system listing like 10 atoms. So later on we found that the best way maybe do what I know right now is it's called the fundamental invariant neural network problem, the fitting procedure. So we just use the FI, we call it, right? So FI is the mathematicians have proven that this is the least, minimal, of the generator of the polynomial, given the permutation symmetry. So it's the number of the, you can see the number of the polynomials, we need, right? It's much smaller than the number of that they use for PIP, actually. So that's this FINN method, right, can apply to much larger system, up to like 20 atoms. So, let me start, right? So, a little more than 10 minutes, right? So, how to construct a surface, right, for water? Okay, so we need to do the ab initio calculations. So that's the points we use so far, right? For diamond, we just use the couple class, the CBS, the theory, right? So it's the best we can do right now. So we calculate about half million, right? These are kind of points, then for triangle, for CBS theory is too expensive, right? So we just use couple class, the AVTZ, the plus mid bound, the level of theory. So we calculate 750 thousand points. So then for tetramer, right, it's very expensive, right? Okay, so far we calculate about 2 million points. Okay, so of course we can always use AVTZ, level of theory again, right? So we use HATZ. We just have AVTZ basis for heavy atom, right? Like for the oxygen atom, we use the AVTZ basis. Okay, so this is the ab initio calculation. So the last law gave the CPU time, right? We use number of days, right? If we use 10,000 CPU cores, so it's very expensive. For tetramer, so far we spend 100 half a year, right, on 10,000 CPU cores. So a lot of money, right? So then once you have the points, we need to do the machine learning, right? So we just use FINN to do machine learning. So then the problem is once you give very large data set, right, the machine learning is also very expensive. Okay, for example, to learn the potential surface for tetramer, right? So on one GPU, 100 GPU, right? So we need 23 days. Okay, so if right now we use in parallel, right? For a GPU card in parallel, so about 1 week, right? So we can run one training. But the problem is, we have to perform 20 to 30, right? Every time we need to perform 20 to 30 training and select the best of the fitting, right? So it's very expensive for the training, even. So so this is comparison, right? So the latest compared to Aqua and MB Pore 2023, right? So you can see, no matter in the range, right, or the energy range, or the accuracy, right, or the surface is much, much better, right? So as the error is about one tenth of their accuracy, okay. So this is two body. So these three bodies are the same, right? So we achieved accuracy of 1.6, right, wave numbers. It's very, very small. So then for four body is the same, right? So for four body, so we achieved accuracy of 0.79, the wave numbers, right? So in comparison, their accuracy is about 7 to 10 wave numbers, right? So again, it's a factor of 10, okay? Then the range is also, our range is much larger than, they are existing two surface. So then we can compare, for the cluster, we can do a very simple comparison, right? So the, like for the, this is the, uh, uh, the 8 the isomer of the hexamer. So then the total energy is about 40 something kilocal per mole, right? So then we can test the calculate the two body, three body, and the four body interaction energy, right? And compare to the initial result. So you can see for aqua and MB pore, the average the difference is about 0.2, the kcal per mole, right? So but OR is much smaller. You can see it's the if I enlarge it, it's 0.02 about, right? So again, it's reduced by a factor of 10, the accuracy. So then, I think the cluster problem is solved, right? So we can use the surface to calculate the energy of a cluster very accurately, right? Almost as accurate as ab initio method, because for ab initio method, once go beyond hexamer, right? You cannot use a couple cluster with large basis anymore. So you still have to use some approximation, right? So we our surface, I think in some sense can be better than ab initio calculation, the calculation. So then, for liquid, right, it's much challenging, right? So we have to use because there are many terms, right, in all the potential. So it's MD simulation is very expensive. So for example, if we have to use only simulate 256 watt, right, for 200 picosecond, we need to simulate 73 hours on our 100 car. It's very expensive. But if you want to use include a quantum effect, right, you have to use 24 cars, right? So these 24 bits, so we need 85 hours on these 24 100 cars. So it's a very expensive calculation also. But of course, if we have the good enough surface of we can perform this kind of calculation, right? So the problem is, how do we know, right, our surface is large enough, right, to cover sufficient large range, right, to the result we get is converged. So that's the big problem. So this is challenges in fitting accuracy and the range convergence of four body potential. Actually, two body and three body is relatively simple. We converged this very quickly. But then for four body, it's very challenging problem. So you can see our fitting accuracy very high, right? Range is quite large, right? We put it here as 18 astron, right? But actually the problem is this is the largest bound, right? We have some points there. We cannot converge all the range, right, within this the all distance. So what kind of we have to first we have to figure out some parameter, right? We to converge the calculation. So that we found the best parameter is on left side, right? So we four body you have tetramer you have four water, right? So we first connect the two water with the shortest distance, right? We call it R1. Then the R2 is the remaining two body, right? The two water, right? It's R2. Then R3 is the shortest distance between the R1 and R2, this one of them, right? So then we multiply them together, right? R1 times R2, R3, right? These are called R. So this is the parameter we use to try to converge it, the full body potential. So the middle one show you for R equal to in the range of 90 and 100, right? So there in total we have 250 configurations these kind of energies, right? So this is a fitting error. It's very small, right? So it's the 0.015 wave numbers. Very tiny, right? It's essentially fitting error is tiny, right? So at the beginning, I think this, we should converge the calculation, right? But the problem is, once after we do MD simulation, we found, the density of the water, right? There are seven surfaces. We calculate seven surfaces, So the average energy was still fluctuating a little bit, right? As a function of R, right? So on the right, you can see, right? So for different surfaces, but this difference is tiny, right? So you can see it's the average energy in terms of 0.02, this kind of the wave number. It's a tiny energy difference, right? So there are some difference over there. So I don't know, at the beginning, we don't know if this kind of the surface can give us a converged result, right? But unfortunately, it turned out, right? So this is the middle one, it's the density of water, right? It's a function of the surface, it's a function of the cutoff distance. So you can see at okay, short distance, all the surface give you the okay, more or less the same result, right? It's the difference is about 0.2%, although the density of water fluctuation, right? It's very small. But the distance increase, right? So to 100, okay, so we still have more than 1 point something, right? Percent in difference in density, okay? So of course it's not bad, right? So this means totally from the first principle, okay, you also, it's important, you can see, once you get, okay, 80 or 90, right? The density is more or less flat, right? It's not the trend that changes. So this means we can converge maybe the density of water, right? If we can extend our surface to this cutoff distance equal to 100. But the problem is right now, there's still some fluctuation of density, right? But if we select one of them, for example, right? Select the green one, okay, we calculate the density of water, right? So compared to experiment, okay, so we get this right side of the figure, right? So you can see its agreement with experiment is not bad, right? But somehow it's under, okay, experiment, right? That is by, 0.6% about. So, but actually this is the quantum effect we know, right? So if we use PIMD, right? So to include the quantum effect, right? So we can get this cross point. So it's essentially the same as the experiment. So this means if we can select one of the surface, good surface, right? So we can really can achieve a very very good density, from the calculation. So then you may ask, right? For heavy water, how about for heavy water? The quantum effect maybe it's not strong, right? What happened, right? So we can see, that this is for heavy water, right? It's essentially the same as the experiment, Or difference only less than 0.1%, right? So it's it's very accurate, right? The surface. So once you have we have a surface, we can do other calculation, right? So for example, for the right side one, we can calculate RDF, right? So essentially same as the experiment. Then for diffusion constant, right? So what we get from MD is 0.2, right? So we know, the quantum effect will increase the diffusion constant a little bit. So this should be very close to experiment, right? Then the middle one is very interesting, okay? So this means that, if we only include the two-body interaction, right? So the water is the same as normal the substance. So this means the density will decrease, with temperature. Will decrease with temperature increase, right? The yellow line, So the straight line. But after we add the three-body potential, right? So getting flat, a little bit flat, but still, decrease all the way, right? As temperature increase. But only after we include, four-body interaction potential, right? So the water becomes water, we know, actually. Yeah. So it's still very interesting. I think it's very interesting. So this means four-body interaction potential, right? So it's very important, right, for the water we know, actually. Then you may ask, how about the five-body, right? But actually, we have some, five-body potential, it's but they're quite a small, the range is not very big, right? But add the five-body potential, right? This density of water will not change anymore, actually. So this means the full density of water, right? Four-body potential is sufficient, actually. So then we can compare with our result with some early studies from the DFT, another one from MB Paul, right? 2023, right? So the middle one is from the hybrid DFT simulation, right? So you can see the difference is more than the first line, right? It's the experiment, the middle one is the theory, right? So the difference is larger than 6%, right? So it's off quite a lot, right? So the for the MB Paul, right? It's it's not bad, right? You can see it, right? So original MB Paul is the difference is slightly larger at low temperature, but the new one is slightly better. But the problem is the MB Paul use TTM, right, for long range, right? So then we may ask if the long range of TTM potential is good enough, right? So because we have a lot of initial data points, so we can make a comparison, right? So the left one is the error from TTM force field, right? For full body interaction. Middle one is our surface. So you can see, the error is about our error, fitting error is about a factor of 30, right? Smaller than TTM force field. So it's a huge difference, right? So the problem is, okay, even our surface is not converged, right? So you can imagine the TTM force field, right? For long range point, it's not right, cannot be right, right? So large difference, how can be right, right? So it's not right. So maybe the water density provided by TTM force is actually quite close to experiment, right? It's some kind of a compensation of error, right? The short range and the long range compensation of error. The tune of parameter, the result, right? So the job is not done, right? So we should finish, right? So this means that we keep on adding the points. So eventually, I hope, right? So we can converge the middle point. So for all the surface, we train, right, from the machine learning. So the surface, the density can be about 2.23%, right? So this is in short range, right? In this way, I think that the surface is totally converged. Then from that surface, we can do all the simulation for liquid water to give you the answer that what's the structure of the water, right? Because it's very expensive, right? Now, both from ab initio calculation and from the fitting and from the MD simulation, right? So each period take about 1 month. So this means we spend 10 days, right, to add points, 10 days to fitting, right? 10 days for ab initio calculation. So I don't know how many iterations we need to go on, right? We still need the 10, well, I hope it's less than 10, right? So I hope sometime next year, we can get a good surface, right? Finally surface for the surface. So in conclusion, I think it's the structure of water is highly sensitive to force field, right? So machine learning gives both hope and great challenge, right? So it's a challenge to ab initio calculation because we use 10,000, the CPU cost, right? We still, half a year, right, to do the ab initio calculation. Okay, then for machine learning, it's very expensive, right? Then for MD simulation based on our surface, right, it's very expensive. Okay, in particular, the full body potential is very hard to converge accuracy and for range, it's very accuracy. So I don't know, it's maybe the method, right? We still can develop a more efficient and high precision, the fitting method. Okay, then what we use is called the FINN method, right? But even for FINN method, I don't know if there's some, the algorithm, right? For training, it's much faster than what we are using, right? It still can help us to speed up the calculation. Okay, so finally, I want to thank to my collaborator, Xuxing here, then all the students and the funding agency. Okay, it's over time, right? Thank you.
Thank you so much for the sharing. Thank you. And next, we're going to have another keynote speaker, Professor Xuxing, Professor, Department of Chemistry, Fudan University, to share about towards accurate and efficient theoretical modeling of heterogeneous catalysis. Let's welcome Professor Xu.
Thank you very much. I would like to start by thanking the organizers, in particular Professor Yan and Professor Xuemin Yang for inviting me here. So I'll be talking on the towards accurate theoretical modeling on heterogeneous catalysis. So maybe it's like Donghui's project, it's only towards. So, of course, heterogeneous catalysis is one of the pillars of our industry. I may take ammonia synthesis as an example. So you can see that with the help of this catalysis, the dramatic increase for the agricultural production was estimated to support the world's half of the world's population in 2008. So another example is Zignata catalysis, and it's used to produce plastic. And so you can see that plastic is everywhere, and so it's actually fundamentally transform our society. So catalysis is something to enabling alternative pathway to with a low barrier. So in this way, you can have enhanced activity and selectivity to understand how catalysis is working. And so it is really important to understand how the chemical species interacting with the surface of the catalysis. Of course, with gradually deepened understanding, and now catalysis is starting from a descriptive investigation to a discipline that we can make a prediction. So. It's true that the catalysis is central to the chemical production, but it's also many challenges facing the current development of the human society. And for example, heterogeneous catalysis actually use almost one-fourth of the energy consumption. And also, there's a huge crisis from the waste plastic. And so there's a great potential and great challenge and great need to develop better catalysis to decrease the energy consumption and to reduce the environmental impact. So, of course, the development of a catalysis used to be trial and error experimentation, but now, thanks to, on the one hand, the progress in characterization, and on the other hand, the advanced quantum chemical computational methods, so we are now coming closer to rational design. So, DFT is one of the very important quantum mechanical methods. It's based on the theorem that the density, ground state density, uniquely determines the many bodies' energy. But the exactly functional is unknown. So in practice, approximation are needed. And so the quest for better and better functional to improve the precise prediction of the DFT is continued. So due to the very good balance between accuracy and efficiency, and so DFT is now the leading first principle methods used in many fields. So more than 90% of theoretical calculations are done with DFT, and also because the functionals are known, so certain approximation had to be used, and according to the statistics, the functional that is most popular in chemistry is Bessrep, and often run with a Gaussian for molecular system, and the functional that is really popular for material science is PPE, often run with WASP, imposing the periodic bound condition. So Bessrep used to be the number one choice, and now this is a much more recent statistics done by DOE in their supercomputer, and you can see more than one-third of their supercomputer are running this DFT calculations, and most of them are done with this WASP. So this in a way reflect the importance for developing new catalysis on catalysis for the computational for the importance for the computational catalysis. But for heterogeneous catalysis, this is where small molecules met the bulk solids. So in fact, every surface reaction can be related to the gas phase reaction by the chemisorption energy. So to this end, we need in the first place to describe the gas phase reaction suitably, and so we can have a good description on things on the surface. So here I would show you Because PPE was have been using so intensively. So I show you an example that the gas phase reaction for CO, carbon monoxide direct dissociation and the CO hydrogenated dissociation. And you can see that for the gas phase of this direct dissociation, let's say add of 20 kilocarbon per mole negative, and for the hydrogenated dissociation, there's another add of 12 kilocarbon per mole. And then for this surface reaction to be accurate, and we would rely on the ADO cancellation on different surface, different metals, and also different surface. And so this would be too good to be true. So if this is quantitative ADO, we may also have this qualitative ADO. So this is an example for CO adsorption. So why experiment to show that it's a top side, but if you done a DFT calculation, this will show that it prefer to absorb on the bridge side or the hollow side. And this is because the conventional DFT suffer from this so-called delocalization ADO. So for the fractional charge behavior of this functional, you should have this straight line interpolation of this integer point. But for the conventional functional, you have this convex ADO, and so this will lead to the 5 sigma orbital too high lying and the 2 pi orbital too low lying. So in this way, because it's too high, and so the 5 sigma donation was underestimated, and because the 2 pi star is too low lying, and so this pi back donation was overestimated. And so you can compare the Homer-Luhmer energy and also the Homer-Luhmer gap with the reference, and you can see the arrows and obvious. And here's our functional, XYG3, and there's a good agreement for the Homer-Luhmer and also the gap. And if you look at the fractional charge behavior, and you can see this is fundamentally correct. So then, what is the XYG3 functional? So over the 50 years, and there are many functional developed depending on different principles, using different descriptors. So PPE is only a LAN2 functional, and so it's far away from the heaven of chemical accuracy. And XYG3 is a top-down functional. It's use information from both unoccupied orbital and occupied orbitals. It's developed based on this adiabatic connection formalism and combined with Golin-Lowy-Weiss gain order perturbation. Specifically, the initial point is a Hartree-Fock exchange for this adiabatic connection formalism from non-interacting system to fully interacting system. And the PT2 is the initial slope. And so the XYG3 functional is actually a double hybrid. So mixing the Hartree-Fock PT2 and with DFT exchange and correlation functional. So here we because we have included the perturbation theory, and so the scaling is increased. We actually have to balance the accuracy and also the efficiency. And you can see we can understand that it's only when two electrons of opposite spin they can make a contribution to the chemical bonding. So if we only describe the opposite spin contribution explicitly, we can reduce the scaling from n to the fifth power to n to the fourth power. And we also understand that it's only when these two opposite spin electrons are in close proximity that is making important contribution. So with this local picture, and we can even reduce this scaling to n to the third power, and then this is now closing to the self consistent field calculations. So here shows the performance, and we can use a heat of formation as a measure of the description of for the covalent bonding, and you can see that we're using the GN set as a measurement for the accuracy, functional accuracy for description of the covalent bonding. And here you can see that the new functional is approaching something to the couple cluster theory for the covalent bonding. And here it's for reaction very high prediction. So also we have a very good results as compared to the QCI SDT results. And here shows PBE bisrelip. And it's very important to emphasize that many functional do not have a uniformed adult distribution for different kinds of a reaction. So here we include something like a heavy atom reaction. Hydrogen transfer unimolecules, and so for unbiased description of the mechanism, you should better have a uniform description of all different kinds of barriers, and so you can have an unbiased description. And this is for non-bonded interaction. We also have a hydrogen bond, charge transfer, dipole interaction, weak interaction, pepper stacking, and you can see that the new functional can also achieve a good the description for the non-bonded interaction. So I emphasize again, so it's important to have an unbiased description of a different kind of different types of the reaction, so you can have a good understanding of the mechanism. And this is for energy, and this is for geometry. So the new functional can have a good description for the geometry of a non-covalent bonding, covalent bonding, and also transition state. So this is very important. So then the question is, can we do catalysis? If we want to do catalysis, the question alternatively is, can XDH functional good performance for molecular system be extended to the bulk solid? So when you're looking for the performance of the bulk solids, and then you have to include periodic bound condition for the three dimensional. So then, in addition to this n to the fourth power on the base set for the electronic repulsion integration, you have an additional curse of dimensionality with respect to the K mesh. So now it's really crucial to have a well balanced K mesh oriented parameterization. So eventually we can put side by side in this table. The cohesive energy of a few solids, and also atomization energy for small molecules. And you can see that the bisrelip is indeed good for small molecules, bonding of small molecules, but not so good for the cohesive energy of the solids. And PBE, on the other hand, is good for solids, but not good, so good for molecules. And so now we are happy to see that the new functional can put these two on the equal side, holding a potential to do accurate calculations on solids, catalysis. But then the key question is, again, we need accuracy and efficiency. It is true that from SCF, from Hartree-Fock, we need to include gradually better and better correlation effects. But then the computation is too demanding. And so the good way, of course, is to use this QMM methods, and Professor David is here. And so our way is, maybe we can do a normal PBE calculation. So with a periodic bound condition with WASP, like everybody are doing here. And so on the other hand, we can cut out the class model and do the X, Y, G, 3 calculations on cluster. So in this way, we update the description of the PBE for chemsorption bond to the description of the X, Y, G, 3. And so you can see that the performance is much improved from the original PBE and to for adsorption energy description and to now the X, Y, G, 3. We call XYG3 at PBC, and the idea is to do reduced below 0.1 electron volt. So here I show an example for the CO2 electrocatalysis CO2R to seal on the copper surface, and this is now a very important reaction for CO2 carbon neutrality. And people have been using WASP to do this kind of calculation very often. And immediately you can see that the potential energy surface in terms of this Nosikoff's computational hydrogen electrical method is very different. And so we can compare this calculation results with the onset potential for the copper 111 surface and the copper 100 surface. And you can see the agreement is quite good for the onset potential. And also you can compare this value to the experimental value for these two surfaces on equilibrium potential, and also the agreement is very well. But then there's a huge difference for the common functional with PBE and also PBE plus D. And this difference is not only quantitative, it's also qualitative, because the rate determining step are completely changed in this sense. And so what's important, what's the next to do? And actually, very recently, Science published a review paper emphasizing the central role of density functional theory in the AI age. So DFT are using to generate many data. But actually, most of these data are at GGA level. So this is a few years ago, natural cover paper, and so showing that the machine learning techniques could revolutionize how material science is done. So the very positive message is we're now seeing that a real convergence of what the experiment wants and what the series can deliver. But there's another emphasize here, the truth is some models come with theory itself, and we may never be able to correct them. So also very recently, there's a Nature editorial and saying that for chemists, the AI evolution has yet to happen, because it's only when the machine learning system in chemistry need accurate and accessible training data. Otherwise, this could be a hype over a hope. So we also have some attempts using machine learning to improve functional development. This is one of the famous example, DeepMind 2021. And so using machine learning help to develop advanced DFA. So you can see the key point here is they actually constrain this linearity conditions into the training set. And so even though this is forced learned functional, it's only a hybrid functional, it was claimed that it could achieve an accuracy which is compared to the double hybrid functional. Of course, one thing is they still are using this plus D left out the dispersion, and also they use the mean absolute deviation, the average of all this using this GMTK55 data set. Because this is unweighted, and so for some set with really small interaction, like non-bounded interaction, this will be hidden in this kind of MOM. So our way is to use machine learning to learn this strongly correlated system for this dissociation system. And in this way, on top of the XDH functional, we have the strong, strongly correlation term to describe this dissociation curve. So you can see that this is a N2 dissociation. Even the gold method CCSDT will fail for this case. But then with this machine learning curve, we can have machine learning functional, we can have a very smooth curve close to the reference data. And you can see also for the GMTKM5, for the MOM and the weighted, so we can both have very good results. We have also applied this to some chemisorption system, and this is for methanol chemisorption on the copper-1-1 surface, and immediately you can see the differences between this new functional and the PPE functional. The differences not only in the barrier heights, but also in the chemisorption step. So here's a summary. You have to balance the accuracy and the efficiency. And I quote Matthias Schoeffer's paper, Physical Review Letters paper in 2007. The electronic structure theory is the base of the multi-scale modeling of materials property and function. Obviously, if the needed accuracy is lacking at this base, there will be little hope that the accurate prediction can be made at any level of modeling that follows. So this is what we've been trying here for so many years, and now we have XYG3 functionals, and we also using this XO PPC models, we can extend this to the surface. But I would also emphasize that this is only a static picture. Again, take ammonia dissociation as an example. You can see that we can, starting from choosing some model system, some species, some surface for the model system, and then we can compute the ammonia adsorption and the first NH dissociation, second and third, and then the combination of the N2 and NH, and then we complete potential energy surface. And so this is a microscopic properties. But the real catalysis happen is when one molecule, there's one more molecules on the surface. When one ammonia is adsorption on the surface, there are many other species already dissociated on the surface. So you can see hydrogen and NH and N, and this species will diffuse on the surface. So they all form a very complex network. So you to really coming from this microscopic to this macroscopic, you need to integrate all these elementary steps together. So this is a very important stage. So if we say this is stage one, and then you have to include this stage two from microscopic property to the real macroscopic understanding. So we have been also doing the kinetic Monte Carlo simulation on this part, and so I show some reference here in case some of the students would interested to know the details of this process. So many thanks to all the students and the group members and the collaborators. And with that, I would like to thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you so much, Professor Xu. Thank you, and please be seated. Next, we're going to have another keynote speaker, Professor Adan Azubru-Guzik, Professor of Chemistry and Computer Science and Director, Acceleration Consortium, University of Toronto. He is going to tell us about artificial intelligence and automation for modern chemistry. So now let's welcome Professor Adan Azubru-Guzik.
Hello, thank you. I decided to walk around to wake you up because I'm the last speaker of the session. So it's so I want to tell you today about theory, but also about experiment. And I will tell you why I started doing experiment. And I called my experiment self-driving lab, so I'll tell you about that. So the motivation connects to the previous speaker. The discovery of almost every catalyst or every material, for example, think of a battery or solar cell, for example, lithium-ion battery, for example, takes 25 years between this original scientific discovery and the technological development. Professor Levitt told us that we have to think about it in a crisis mode, and 25 years is very, very long time scale for climate change. So we need to accelerate the way we discover and then translate the discoveries of materials into society. And that has been the motivation of trying to rethink the way we do science or the way we do molecular engineering and materials engineering into actually trying to accelerate the whole process. So I'll give you just one example. Raise your hand if you actually use a cell phone. Okay. So most of your cell phones use an OLED screen. Okay, and the OLED screen was discovered by Professor Tang, which actually is from here, from Hong Kong, right, in 1987. So since the discovery of Professor Tang, it took 20 years for the first cell phone, the Samsung cell phone, to come out into the market. Okay, so that's pretty cool. That's an example. And I'll tell you about emitters. So I started with cell phone today. And why is it so important also for the economy? Universal Display Corporation, this large company started by Stephen Forrest, actually is a strong buy in the stock market and because they basically control the entire OLED materials market. So that's a pretty good example. So let's talk about computational screening today, right? High throughput virtual screening. So that's the first idea that I had when I started in this problem is, why don't we just basically throw a lot of computer time to the problem and actually start computing really, really quickly, these organic emitters. And around the time of 2014 to 2016, Samsung gave me a very large grant. And it was the first paper in my group where we used machine learning to predict 900,000 molecules out of 100,000. So we got a speed up of 10. And as a computational guy, I was very happy. I got the Nature Materials paper. But I was pretty sad about something. The fact that we computed or predicted about 1 million compounds, and we were only able to do 30 experiments, out of which 3 were top candidate materials. That's the difference between the throughput that we can achieve in computation nowadays and the throughput we can achieve in experiment. So I started thinking about that problem and realizing that if you have a computational person that passes the problem to the experimentalist, which passes the problem to the device engineer, and passes the problem to the industry, and they're all disconnected, you're never going to get fast. You have to look at the entire pipeline from discovery all the way down to production and try to integrate it. And even in the discovery, what I'm gonna be talking today, you wanna think about how to use your data efficiently. So previously in the 1990s, people were very excited about a technique called combinatorial chemistry. And now we don't talk about combinatorial chemistry because in some sense it was a failure. Why is that? Because chemical space is 10 to the 80 or 10 to the 120 possible compounds or materials. If you put a grid in chemical space, and one of the previous speakers was talking about grids, you're basically done. You cannot do a grid in material space. You have to actually learn it iteratively. Therefore, using machine learning, Bayesian models, if you do tens to hundreds of experiments at a time, update your Bayesian prior and continue doing experiments, you are driving around in chemical space. I call that self-driving lab, right? You go to a target, which is a particular property, and slowly get there by actually iterating over experiments, okay? So, in this paper in 2018, I actually tried to write what are the challenges for theoretical chemistry for the 21st century, which are very different to the theoretical chemistry challenges for the 20th century. I don't have time in this talk to go through them, but I'm gonna tell you about one of them, which is the self-driving lab, okay? So, but before that, okay, I forgot. Let me just tell you the progress on machine learning for molecular design. We heard beautiful talks about machine learning for predicting the structure of water, such a fundamental problem, or for understanding catalysis. Here, I'm gonna move to small molecule design for drug discovery and for organic emitters. So I'm very interested in just designing small molecules. So this is now my third most cited paper, okay? It got a lot of attention because at the beginning, it sounds like a very stupid problem. It says, I'm gonna make a machine learning model that given a molecule reproduces a molecule. So if you give it benzene, it will give you benzene back. So we say, wow, that sounds really exciting. If you give it water, it will give you water back. So what's the point with that? The point is that it takes discrete molecules and compresses them into a continuous differentiable space in a reversible manner by using an encoder and a decoder. So you encode into a continuous differentiable space and then you decode from it. And the decoder is the magic here. Because that means that if we actually have the decoder, we can actually do what is called inverse design. Go to property that you want and back to structure. So you solve the inverse design problem. That's why this paper is so important. So you can climb the property properties mountain and then go back and say, which is the molecule? And that's where a common friend with Professor Levitt came to me. I was in Boston and he said, I want to meet you. I have a company that does this kind of stuff too, right? I want to talk to you about this. And started collaborating with this guy called Alex Shabarenko, which I'll tell you in the next slide. But this is something I'm going to tell everybody here. Raise your hand if you do some machine learning in your life, okay? The most important thing for the young scientist here is that the most important thing is data, then the representation, and then the model, okay? We heard about invariant representations early on, and data as well, calculating a lot of data to do these functionals, right? And the water potentials, right? So this is a series of models, the least important thing. So we put the generative models out there, but my group now uses genetic algorithms. You know, we use GANs. It doesn't really matter too much what is your generative model. As a matter of fact, Monte Carlo molecular dynamics are generative models of the Boltzmann distribution, right? So generative models for language are very popular nowadays, but generative models for images, et cetera, are nothing more than generating samples from a probability distribution, okay? And now, of course, my group is using language models, and there are some papers there that explain to you how to generate protein structures with language models, for example. But this is a paper I was talking about. Alex and his team use our autoencoder idea to actually encode and decode molecules in chemical space for drug discovery. And in 42 days, it went from just a target, which was DDR1 kinase, to a molecule, to a rat, right? And it got recognized as one of the top technologies of 2020 in MIT Technology Review. Time flies, 3 years later, all the drug discovery companies, the major ones, have an AI for drug discovery program. This happens everywhere, okay? And actually, Silico Medicine is basically based here in Hong Kong, and they're very popular. And apparently, Alex is very active in WeChat. Some people were telling me that. Recent paper, I just added it here because it's with Professor Levitt and myself and in Silico. In 30 days, we use now three different AI tools, AlphaFold, PandaOmics, and degenerative models to generate a liver cancer inhibitor. And this is a Royal We. This is work done in Silico, and I just kind of help them as a consultant. But it tells you the idea that AI for drug discovery is here to stay. So now, how about other aspects of drug discovery? I'm very excited about this collaboration with Professor Christine Allen. I've been working with her for 4 years, and the best results are about to come. They are not yet published, but we have a few papers published of machine learning for a very interesting problem, drug delivery, right? If you think about how mRNA was delivered, you had these liquid nanoparticles that take mRNA and actually deliver it to your body. That's how the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines worked, right? So it turns out in drug discovery, it's seldom to optimize the chemical composition space of the pills that you take, the injections that you take, et cetera. So we have very, very good results on taking a commercial pill, any commercial pill you want, grinding it, looking at its bioavailability, and then with machine learning, optimizing bioavailability by a factor of 2 or 3 in a week. Basically means drugs, delivery of drugs is really not optimized by AI yet. So we're very excited about this collaboration. Now, generative models can work for reticular materials, for example. This is a paper that we have in MOFS with Zhenpeng Zhao, which is now a professor in China, used to be in my group. But now I'm gonna move to the next, one of the challenges that I posed in that paper, which is a challenge inspired by Perelov Levdin's 1957 paper, where he says, a computational chemist not only needs to actually just do theory, but also has to impact humankind, okay? So we just heard about catalysis, right? So this is a very important problem. And that's where the idea of the self-driving lab comes in. I'm gonna skip this. Looking at the time, this is not relevant. Okay, so let's talk about self-driving labs. I like to look at history always, so let's talk about the first chemical automation that was extremely impactful. This is the automated synthesis of peptides. Biologists are way ahead of us chemists because they can automate peptide synthesis, DNA synthesis, sugar synthesis. And the way they can do it is obviously because in nature, chemistry is modular. So I'm gonna get back to it. How can we have organic chemistry be modular, right? How can we build molecules out of blocks? Okay, so obviously this led to a Nobel Prize. This is a prize ceremony. We're talking about prizes all the time. Well, Bruce Merrifield got the 1984 Nobel Prize for the development of this automatic synthesizer, okay? So the first self-driving lab, a lab that is actually looking at the reaction conditions and optimizing, was published when I was 2 years old. This is Winnikov, which is still alive, actually. He worked at SK, of currently now GSK, and used a PDP-11 computer and programmed in BASIC an iterative reaction optimizer. 1978, isn't it amazing, right? So we have the modern version of that, basically an AI controlling an experimental tool using tools from high-performance computing, like density functional theory, all to actually inform the models as well as neural networks. So basically, anything that you can add of information to the system so that every experiment is as valuable as possible, right? So what is, again, the difference between high-throughput experimentation or high-throughput ritual screening and a self-driving lab is the fact that you are not just doing a random grid, but you're actually iteratively optimizing and getting the, every point will allow you to actually maximize information content and hone in into the target that you want. Generative models are fantastic, but the problem with generative models is they generate molecules sometimes that are unsynthesizable, a little bit crazy, a little bit weird molecules. So our approach for making materials is to only explore the space that my robot can make. So I make a robot that makes materials and I say, AI, only explore the synthesizable materials by this robot. Now, of course, I'm exploring a much, much smaller version of chemical space. In the experiments I'll show you, we're exploring 180,000 molecules, right? But we don't need to make the 180,000 molecules. We only need to make about 1,000 of them to make progress. So I argue that in theoretical chemistry of this century, a lot of the stuff that I'm showing you in this slide is going to be very important. And students around this generation should think about how to store the data on the cloud even, how to have natural language interfaces. Right? How to actually do the Bayesian optimization. We have many papers in my group just about the Bayesian optimization piece, okay? So those are the things that my group thinks a lot about nowadays. So now I'm gonna tell you about our application in my remaining 7 minutes before the panel discussion, 17 minutes. Organic lasers. What if now instead of having an OLED, we have an OLED that emits light coherently? Why would you want to do that? For augmented reality, that's huge because your glasses will emit light directly to your retina. Sounds very, very kind of Blade Runner-esque, but I think it's a very interesting thing to have information directly in your eyes. It's an example of one of the applications. But for that, let's have a history of science, right? How many of you know who Hendrik Schön is, or was? He's actually alive, actually, Hendrik Schön. Hendrik Schön was one of the biggest fraudsters of material science, okay? I recommend you to buy this book and read it. It's a fantastic story about how Hendrik Schön faked the development of organic semiconductors, organic superconductors, and organic lasers around the 90s in Bell Labs, okay? And it was around the time that one of my heroes of all time, Professor Chihaya Adachi in Japan, in Kyushu, was a postdoc, and he was really pissed off because he was trying to reproduce organic laser results of Dr. Schön, this fakester. It took him about 30 years or 20 years more or something to actually publish the first functioning, actually reasonable, organic semiconductor solid-state laser. You can see the molecules there. These are very long, electron-rich molecules. Have a huge transition dipole to shuffle the electron charge back and forth, emit light to you extremely well. And he had only published 10 materials in 3 years. So that was around the time I was moving to the University of Toronto, and I said, this is the material to try to optimize, right? Because it just started, right? We had to have a material where there was nothing. There was only 10 published materials. So I built a robot to make a self-driving lab for organic lasers, in collaboration with Chihaya, by the way. So some physical chemistry, what do you want to do for an organic laser? You want to have basically a molecule that takes a photon and gives the photon back to you with no other parasitic process, like transferring to the triplet manifold, excited state absorption from the singlets, or non-radiative decay, all sorts of things. So we can use physical chemistry models, and now connecting to Professor Sharon Hamish-Schiffer's talk, to actually think about what is the photochemistry of these materials, right? So at the end of the day, it's Jablonski diagrams and parabolas like the ones we saw that ultimately inform our models. We have path integral models that actually build on these parabolas to actually try to model these systems as we actually engineer them, to the point of trying to understand also what is behind, not just to machine learning without understanding the physical chemistry. A very good point that was made this morning. And this is where DARPA, by the way, DARPA is one of the most amazing agencies, my opinion. They've been funding me since I started my career, and I'm just, I love these guys because they actually have very important challenges, and they had a challenge based on that science paper I showed you in 2018 with Benjamin Sanchez. When it just came out, DARPA made an entire program around it. So we won one of the grants. I guess we wrote the science paper that inspired the program. And the grant of the Accelerated Molecular Discovery Program, we called it Madness. And it was madness because all the characters here, Lee Cronin, Marty Burke, Bartosz Grzybowski, Jason Hein, and myself, tried to have in 5 years develop self-driving labs. Okay? So first of all, how do we build the molecules we're going to be inspired in biology? I think most of the speakers talked about inspiration in biology or biology in this talk. Okay? And what do we mean by inspiring by biology here? We're going to actually inspire ourselves in the synthesis procedure. Okay? Professor Levy told us about how we synthesize in our body the proteins. Okay? It's block by block. So Marty Burke, one of my collaborators, has inspired the organic chemistry community saying, we have done organic chemistry all wrong. We do very complicated, sophisticated, obscure reactions rather than having a very, very good reaction like the Suzuki coupling or the Buchwald-Hargreaves coupling, optimizing such reactions and use more complex blocks. Therefore, the robots can actually synthesize block by block like nature, like the ribosome. That's what we do. Okay? So this is the lab at Toronto. We have also a lab in Glasgow, a lab in Urbana-Champaign, and a lab in British Columbia with different capabilities. My lab is an organic chemistry lab, analytical chemistry lab, and a physical chemistry lab controlled by a theoretical chemist. That's called Madness. And you can see it here from the back. There's a synthesizer, an HPLC, and an optical table. Molecules are synthesized there in the synthesizer. They go back to the HPLC for semi-prep separation. We exchange solvents in the platform you see in the front, and we do optical measurements on the molecules, and we can measure, for example, the overlap between the absorption and emission spectrum of the molecule, or its time-resolved emission properties. In a weekend, you can do 40 molecules. So Chihaya published 10, now we can do 40 in a weekend. And that was our Hello World paper. This advanced materials this year, where we actually just synthesized very simple, single reaction, one cap, many cores. That's the idea, is what can you fit in the robot in a single weekend? That was a challenge, right? So we did that. And here is, people love videos of robots, so I'm gonna show you my little robot. That's the most expensive salt and pepper shaker in history. It weighs our catalysts. You can see our reactor. It's a little bit more like 1990s Swiss technology. It's a ChemSpeed. It's actually there. It's a liquid handler. But the way we think about it as theoreticians is as a GPU. The robot itself is kind of like something we're controlling, right? So we're controlling experimental chemistry all with Python. So raise your hand if you're a computational chemist or whatever. That's amazing, right? Now you can control experiments. Your experimentalist, this also helps you. We're not going to get you out of your job. Han Hao, from my group, he actually built, inspired by the technology from Marty Burke, a $5,000 version of that million-dollar robot here. And that's what we did 95% of our reaction. So what you see there is a very simple chemical reactor that is actually doing two-step, one-pot Suzuki couplings in a $5,000 little heater with pumps. So we are going to submit to the archive very soon the design of this so anybody here can replicate it. So this is just the proof is in the pudding. Now let me read you this axis. Laser gain is in the y-axis. The probability of a molecule absorbing a photon and giving it back to you in solution, we screen for these molecules in solution, versus the color. Chihaya's best molecule is 1C, the green molecule. Higher, the better. So just in this experiment, Hello World, where they had many molecules better than Chihaya's, right? So pretty exciting. Just the first run, we were lucky. We used our brain to screen correctly the cores, but still we were able to just run and get the molecules. And you see in the right is the device made in Fukuoka. The excitation energy threshold is very important. That's when the molecules start lacing in the solid state. So you have to see that kind of change. And you see the structure of our best molecule. And you can see also the emission spectrum being narrowed in the cavity, which is a property of being a laser. So now I'm going to tell you about what I think is the future in the last 10 minutes is what we call ACDC, labs delocalized all around the planet. Okay, so our project actually has a lab in Fukuoka, a lab in Glasgow, a lab in British Columbia, Urbana-Champaign, Toronto. So the sun never sets in our empire. Okay, and for that we had to develop software system to actually figure out who has which chemicals have been shipped to who. And I'm gonna make a joke. I'm a Mexican, so I like to ship white powders around the world. Okay, basically, we had to develop new theory, like asynchronous Bayesian optimization, right? We have an experimental database that every time a powder comes back from Urbana, we measure it in Toronto, because Toronto is the only one that has the laser to measure the lasers, okay? So it's funny, to make a laser, you need to measure it with a laser. So everything has to be synthesized and then shipped to Toronto. We update our model and then have a database that asynchronously tells everybody else what to make, okay? And the best compounds are scaled in Vancouver and then shipped to Fukuoka to make devices. Okay? So again, this is a little bit formal for the organic chemists. What we use is boropin, pinacole, borotida, and midaboronate protected molecules that have halogens on one side and a protecting group on the other. And that allows us to do exactly the same thing that nature does, sequential synthesis. So think about it as a Star Wars spaceship. You have the core, a connector, and the wings. So we connect first the wings to the connector and then the connector to the core, all in a single step in solution. Sorry, in two steps in solution. Okay, I'm gonna skip some of the organic chemistry. But very interesting, right? If you use AI to optimize the reaction conditions, okay, just that. We took diverse set of substrates and we tried to optimize the reaction conditions for a Suzuki coupling. We doubled the performance of a generic Suzuki coupling, and that got us a science paper, which was pretty cool, right? Along the way to try to solve this problem, we had to first solve the Suzuki reaction that, since the 1990s, has not been optimized. It's amazing. It's the most used reaction in pharma. And we just doubled its performance with AI for generic substrates. So that means AI can help you. Very important. And this talk is probably the most molecular engineering type of talk here. I'm really becoming more and more of a chemical engineer. So now, that's actually a picture of our substrates there. We did, for sampling a hypercube, over the entire 190,000 molecular space, we ran 500 molecules in 3 months. Now, the whole experiment was about 1,100 molecules because the robot doesn't work all the time. We have to confess, the reason now we have a center in Toronto to try to make this work is because the robot plugs, the software fails, we don't have some reactions at .com, et cetera. Self-driving labs are made with duct and tape right now, and we need to engineer them to be more precise. And that's why the government of Canada just gave us a very large grant to make self-driving labs a very, very robust tool. So they are not as robust as you think. I'm trying to just skip some slides to get, because I am seeing my time, I want to tell you some cool things. So you can see the final molecules that we have. Maybe in this slide is better. When am I going to go? I'm going to go back. Okay, let me tell you about this. I'm doubting because I have so much things to tell you about. Okay, let's talk about this one. So you can see basically how a campaign like this works. During the first 2 years or so, we were testing the self-driving lab, optimizing reaction conditions. We got the science paper along the way. And then we spent a lot of time using hypercube sampling. That's what trains our DFT. And then in the last 3 months, just the last 3 months, we optimized. And in the optimization campaign, we found this amazing molecule that is so much better than Chihaya's. We have about 30 to 40 molecules that we consider extremely high performers and the best in the world right now. Okay. You can see the top molecules in the bottom. This paper has been submitted to a journal and also is in the archive now. And you can see in the right-hand side the molecule with the lowest threshold in the world. Okay. So you also have to do some theory. And so we did some theory making some assumptions about what would be the narrowest emission lines that you can have due to the molecular timescales of molecular emission, right? What would be, in some sense, in physical chemistry, the upper bound for an organic laser? And it is the points that you see there in the top. So you see our robot experimental campaign in the bottom and the physical chemistry prediction of what we believe is the ultimate device that we can make. So you can see there's a lot of room for innovation. We don't have the best organic laser by any means, but that just tells you more or less where we are. So you can see our lasers here. If you shine a laser on our synthesizer, this is how they look. These are perhaps the brightest molecules in the world. Okay, so in my last 5 minutes, let me tell you something interesting. What is this? I have a mess here. Oh, yeah, not a mess. How is the lab gonna look in the future? I don't think the lab is gonna look like we think about it. It's gonna be a human entering our place and actually doing experiments, a humanoid. So we're starting to work towards that. That's a robot in my lab. This is my graduate student, Haoping Xu, or as I learned from Professor Levitt, Xu Haoping, actually taking photos automatically of that glassware with those QR codes to actually generate a data set of computer vision of transparent objects. So 2 years ago, we had the world record on transparent object detection. We bet NVIDIA and Intel, obviously with my computer science collaborators. But we're along the way to actually have robots do chemical experiments in the lab, okay, by using, for example, multi-view training. So the same way when we don't know something, we look around like this to try to figure out what it is. So a robot does the same to actually start picking up transparent objects in very complicated scenarios, right? Because what we really want is a robot that is actually doing chemistry. So for example, this is my student, Naruki Yoshikawa, optimizing the trajectory so you don't spill the liquids, okay? So we're doing all sorts of interesting problems like liquid transfer. We just published a paper on a digital pipette, for example, for this robot. So we're really having a lot of time, a lot of fun, for example, doing these recrystallization experiments. And we're so excited about this simple chemistry. Alan, why are you showing me recrystallization? Because this robot, in principle, one day will enter a regular chemistry lab, use regular chemistry glassware, and therefore democratize automated chemistry, right? So it's very important for the world to have a $20,000 or $10,000 robot do all of this, okay? Another very cool thing is that we actually use natural language. I have a mess in my slides. I don't know what happened here. We have actually natural language to actually control the robot. So in my last 2 minutes, I guess, I'm showing you how to tell it, literally, add 40 grams of acetic acid, and then the robot will do it. And for that, we use the famous ChatGPT. But we have to correct ChatGPT. We cannot just use ChatGPT to do this. We have a clarify our framework to make sure that ChatGPT is not going to do an experiment that explodes or that doesn't work on the robot. So my student, Marta Skreta, has been working on this very simple example. This is actually adding cavash into a beaker to actually do a titration. But you can actually write it in English, and then the robot will actually do the experiment. So this is a very recent archive paper that we have in my group. Just to give you an idea of the crazy things that we're doing right now. My last 2 minutes. Okay, learning from others. This is a paper that we read a lot of philosophy. Okay, actually, we started reading philosophy. We're starting to understand, where is machine learning nowadays? Can a computer understand? Does ChatGPT understand? This was before the ChatGPT revolution. Okay. And what we started thinking about is, and this is the paper, I recommend you to read it, actually, on scientific understanding. We started reading Federer Jebed and a lot of philosophers explaining what the heck is scientific understanding. Raise your hand if you know what is scientific understanding. You're a scientist. Isn't it amazing? Okay, it's amazing that we don't think about what is scientific understanding. So after we read these papers and these books, actually, Mario Crane read most of the books. I read summaries of them because I am very busy, but this is really work of Mario Crane, now professor in the Max Planck Institute of Light. But within this paper, we thought a lot about this. This is a lot of authors in my group. We had lunches talking about this. We found out the following. There's three ways of learning from computers, according to us. The computational microscope, MDQM, StatMech, we saw beautiful examples today. You look at a simulation and you learn by it. You get inference by looking at the simulation of liquid water, of a protein. You look at it and you come up with the simple examples, the rope and string models. That is learning. That's understanding. Okay? Second one is data science. I look at the molecule, machine learning data, and I can inspire myself from the trends that I see there. We also heard about learning from the data science of COVID, right? Learning from the data itself. But number three is, can the agent understand concepts and the relationships? And we found that in a survey that we did over about 80 computational scientists, nobody told us they have a chip tree. And it makes sense because the computers don't have the tools. So there's two conditions for scientific understanding. An Android gains scientific understanding if he understands the qualitative consequences of what happened, right? Understands that, for example, it's very important for proton transfer to for the isotope effect for the proton transfer to be tunneling, and understands what tunneling is, and then thinks about tunneling in catalysis or another application. So that's number one, that he can use it in a different context, less from a protein, but then uses it for catalysis. And the second one, if I can explain to you in a language like Cantonese, Chinese, English, or Spanish, right? ChatGPT is very good at that, but can it really explain it to you? Paradoxically, philosophers believe you cannot understand something until you explain it. So that's the condition number two. And with that, I'm going to end. Thanking you, showing your picture of my research group. And thank you for listening to me as the last speaker. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor. Please remain on stage. So now the morning session is about chemistry, focusing on FEM theory, AI, machine learning, to experimental realization. Today, we're so happy to have experts from the world, and we are going to have the panel discussion. I believe that you would like to know more about their thoughts, their ideas, and I think it will be very interesting because today our speakers are from different sides of the world. So. And now we are going to have the panel discussion. May I invite our moderator, Professor Vivian Wing Van Yam. And also our panelists, including Professor Adam Asuburu-Gusik, Professor Michael Levitt, Professor Sharon Hammershiver, Professor Xu Xin, and also Professor Zhang Donghui. Please come to the stage. So now I may pass the stage to our moderator, Professor Vivian Wing Van Yam.
Okay, so first I'd like to thank all the speakers for their wonderful talk. It has been a very exciting morning and everyone keeping on time. So we have time for the panel discussion. So thank you so much. So we heard really wonderful things about Michael talking about the COVID and then climate change and Sharon about proton couple electron transfer that we use in many energy related catalysis enzyme, and then the very accurate sort of prediction of water properties as well as catalysis from Professor Zhang Donghui and Xu Xin. And of course, Alan ended up very well with the AI, and hopefully you promised that we won't get out of work, so the experimentalists will still be there with the robots helping us to do very dangerous explosive experiments, maybe. So my first question I'd like to sort of direct to you all is that what do you think are the challenges of using computational work? And then there was also a discussion that AI alone won't work, right? We still need the theoretical basis. So what do you think is the challenges now that we would be facing in the next few years, which will be extremely important for exponential growth of these automation, AI, machine learning. So would Michael want to say something first?
So I think the most important challenge is to get used to playing with these tools. I have played with ChatGPT probably 100 times a day for the last 10 months. I have thousands of pages of output and input, and I'm always amazed by the answers. I'm not saying the answers are always right. ChatGPT is terrible at arithmetic. It really is. I mean, it's worse than a 10-year-old. But in terms of concepts and discussing, I'm always shocked. It really has answers about all sorts of things. It's got amazing emotional intelligence. It's great for arguments. It's quite amazing. My limitation in answering questions is the biggest thing. So I think in some ways, these AI models are a bit like experimental science. Don't think you know the answer until you've tried to play with them, because the answers are really surprising. And in terms of the worry about AI, I see this as a symbiosis. In exactly the same way we have man and woman that give us the incredible diversity of life, I think man, woman, and machine is the next step. And I think it's quite clear that no matter how smart AI is, AI plus man plus woman will be much smarter. The diversity is incredibly important, but I encourage everybody, just ask it silly questions. I mean, I have never, very few cases have I not gotten an answer. It writes computer code for me. It finds comments in my old Fortran. It is amazing. So it's something you have to play with to get a feeling for.
Yeah, thank you. So, Alain?
Well, I completely concur. We designed, I think what we had to think about is, as tools come in, we use them. We're using PowerPoint, we don't think about it, but I'm old enough to remember using slides. I use the slides from my PhD candidacy presentation, right? So we're gonna be using these AI tools as our tools, and I hope the robots as well, right? So I think as we start increasing the throughput of our laboratories and being able to do in a weekend what other labs do in months, hopefully the revolution of these self-driving labs will actually spread to many labs around the world, and we will lower the barrier of entry and really democratize chemistry, make chemistry much more accessible, right? So I think the ones that are gonna be left behind, the ones that are not looking at this and learning Python and automation and all that stuff, right? So my advice to the young people is get into data science, play with ChatGPT, program, build your first robotic titrator, and start having fun.
Yeah, thank you. So maybe Sharon, could you share your views?
Sure. I think one of the challenges is getting the data, and I think we heard a little bit about that from these two. Presumably your machine learning predictions are only as good as the data you trained it on, and so there is a challenge to make sure the method you're using to get the data is accurate enough that you're actually going to get reliable results from your machine learning. And I think what this goes back to in my mind is that you can't just stop, say, developing methods to solve the Schrodinger equation better, whether it's the electronic one or the nuclear one, whichever one you're doing. We still need those methods because we still need to generate the data that we're going to train the machine learning on. And the more accurate those methods get, the more accurate our data is going to get. So I think it's not that everybody's going to stop. You might think, oh, method development is going to go out the window. We don't need it. Everything will be machine learning. But everything is based on being able to actually solve the problem, at least for a small data set. And so I think that my advice to people would be, if we're giving advice out to people and junior people training, I think that don't just do machine learning. It's fine to play with the ChatGPT and everything, but you also need to, someone out there has to still be developing the high-level accurate methods, quantum mechanical methods, statistical methods that are going to be used for the training of these machine learning processes.
Thank you. So Professor Zhang? Yeah, so accurate measurements. So can you sort of share your views on what are the challenges and what's your advice?
So I totally agree with that, Sharon, right? So I was very optimistic, right? About 5 years ago, right? I think that with machine learning and highly accurate initial calculations, I can solve all the problems, right? From water, if I add on salt or whatever the solution phase, right? So, but later on, I found it's still very expensive, right? The initial calculations, in particular, the very high-level couple class calculations, very expensive, right? So the thing that the liquid phase is much more complicated than the gas phase problem. So we still need a lot of data, right, to construct the global surface for water, right? So once you add some ion or the organic molecule, I think it's very, still very challenging for us to generate this data, very accurate data, then okay, the, do machine learning and to get a general surface. So the, I think very important to develop the new methodologies like the very accurate, high accurate the DFT series like Xuxing did, right? So as it has been doing, so that to try to the reduce the computational cost for our the very high accurate calculation. Yeah.
Thank you. So, Xin?
Yeah, so I concur with everyone's talk, and so in fact, in my talk, I've been emphasized on the importance of the good quality of the data. But actually, on the other hand, with so many data, and machine learning can actually help because when the data is accumulating, and it's really difficult for the human with human eyes to find the hidden laws, and so machine learning can also help to find the hidden laws from the huge data, and so this is also a very important point here.
Yeah, thank you. So another question I like to sort of like discuss is, so Michael, you talk about not just big data, right? Small data is also very important. So, and so how are you going to see in future, right? So all these developments, right? Theory, very high level theory, computation, you know, AI, machine learning, and all this robotics, automation is going to change the way we operate in terms of the, in the laboratories or in industry, right? Not only in the research laboratories, but in industry, our manufacturing chain and so on. How would you like to, how would you see it?
So, you know, firstly, I don't know, but I am very impressed by the idea of automating a lab. I liked Alan's idea of actually a robot that could probably cook in my kitchen. You know, I think I must emphasize here that ChatGPT, these large language models, are most like something we all love, and that's a phone. When we got our first smartphones, 2007, we didn't know what they were for. We probably thought they were for making calls. And the fact is that we do not know yet the impact of these models. They are so rich, they are so complicated. And I have hundreds of anecdotes where I'm completely blown away by what they can do. Things that aren't even advertised. So for example, in the OpenIA app for the phone, it is the best transcriber of people's voices into text I have ever seen. I have tried Chinese, Korean, Japanese, German, and it gets the words almost letter perfect. That's an amazing thing. If you look at the automatic translations that we were having a year ago, they didn't understand accents. So we are making huge progress. And this is something that no one's talked about. I just saw it myself. And maybe people have talked about it. But I think I really encourage everybody, in the same way I remember early on saying that a smartphone isn't for young people, it's for old people. We need the smartphone. Young people don't need a smartphone, maybe. But the fact remains that all of these things, I think it's very important not to have an opinion until you've actually experienced them. The experience of these large language models, it's not ChatGPT, although it is so far the best one. I'm actually very worried that it's so inaccessible. You know, it will not work from Hong Kong normally, and you know, and I don't know whether this is political or whether it's to restrict the pressure on the computer servers, but I would, you know, try to negotiate a deal with OpenAI that the Hong Kong, you know, IP numbers are acceptable, because it really is important, or else get your own ones. Unfortunately, you know, Bing is to OpenAI what Bing was to Google, greatly inferior. Google's engines are quite good. It's very difficult to get them right, but OpenAI made a jump. It's not for nothing that the value of the company increased 100-fold in less than a year. That is very unusual that a company goes from half a billion valuation to almost 100 billion valuation. There's something really, really special. In my life, I feel that it has changed everything. It's before, you know, there's before ChatGPT and after ChatGPT. It's a bigger discovery in my own life than computers, than the internet, than smartphones, etc. It really is a game changer. But you have to play with it. You have to love it. You have to feel it. It makes mistakes. My friends will make mistakes. In other words, we have to look at, just play. You'll find something about it that will change your life. As for laboratories, I definitely think, I mean, I sort of imagine in the future that everything is going to be data science. We'll be planning the experiments at home. They'll be done by central laboratories. You know, I remember early on in the 80s visiting a lab at Stanford, and they were injecting into cells, and it was terribly painful work and laborious. We need to get rid of people's brains should be thinking about all of these things. We should be designing experiments and not spending too much time. I think we'll miss it. I think we might have to do woodwork as a hobby, because we like using our hands. But for example, if you wanted to build a robot, I am confident that with GPT, I could build a robot. Before this, I would have said, I haven't got a chance. There's no way I'll know what to do. So it really is an enabler of all kinds.
Thank you. So Alan?
Well, in my opinion, yes, the language models are just the tip of the iceberg. Now we just saw the multimodal models, right? So aligning visual input with text. And ChatGPT just added that, those guys and other models. We're playing with that in the context of biology. It's very interesting. We're looking at how can we have models that contain protein sequences, but also graphs of enzyme classes and the graphs of the molecules, the text that describes the function of a protein. And this is a beautiful story. This is a professor that got long COVID, talking about COVID. We started this morning talking about COVID. Professor Chris Madison, and they said, I am gonna now work on AI to solve this problem. So he wants to create a foundational model for biology, and we're looking at this multimodal problem together with him. I'm his chemistry collaborator, I guess. He's basically leading this project, and we're working on this problem. Like, for example, can you show it the protein structure and it tells you the enzyme class? And for that, it's important to have all the text from the internet, but it's also important to show it graphs, to show it molecular structures. So I think the future is going to be models like ChatGPT, but that have multimodal input and output. And they are starting to be built as we speak for more mundane applications. Just last example, robotic planning. When we started doing robotic planning 3 years ago, we went through several steps to plan the actions of a robot. Now with this type of models, we can do that directly from the instruction to the plan, skipping a lot of the work in robotics. So LLMs are transforming also robotics. So it's very interesting to see how a lot of fields will benefit from this kind of obviation of certain steps as you design systems.
Yeah, Sharon?
Yeah, I mean, it's clearly an exciting time for all of this. I admit I haven't spent a lot of time with ChatGPT, but I will go back and play around with it. Now I've been motivated, inspired, I guess, by Professor Leavitt. But you know, I think within my own work, what I showed, certainly machine learning is helping to develop better force fields, more accurate force fields, better functionals, not only electronic, but in our NEO method for electron-proton correlation functionals. There are ways to solve the Schrodinger equation or Newton's equations of motion, you know, faster, you know, follow molecular dynamics faster, sample better. So there's all sorts of exciting directions to explore, and it's going to affect molecular simulations at all levels and all aspects. I still, you know, have to give this sort of reminder, you know, that I still don't think that we can rely entirely on machine learning, and I still think I don't want to see analytical theory die. I don't want to see thinking and creativity suffer in this context of machine learning and AI. So I don't think it has to, but I do think people have to remember that you still need models to test and theories to test, and you still need to understand the concepts and the underlying fundamental principles of what's going on, what's the mechanism, what's happening. I think there is a tendency sometimes for some people to say, okay, I've got this, you know, neural network or whatever, I'm going to plug something gets spit out the other side, I don't care what's happening in the middle, all I want is whatever molecule I can make that's going to do whatever I want it to do in the end, and not think about what's happening in between. So I would say in terms of training students, that it's wonderful if they learn all these techniques of machine learning, but they should also still learn the fundamentals of quantum mechanics, statistical mechanics. If they're in biology, they should still understand how enzymes work and not rely entirely on machine learning, because they'll be better scientists and more innovative if they know all aspects, not only the machine learning, but the other aspects that I'm talking about. So that would be my two cents.
Thank you. So, Xin?
Yeah.
So I also agree with Shannon that fundamental theory is really important. It's not only the data. You can generate huge data. And but like Donghui's work, you have to impose symmetry. You have the PIP, the permutation symmetry, and then you can you are not asking the machine learning to learn this kind of symmetry, to learn the things we prove it is already correct, like Schrödinger equations. And so you should impose this kind of basic symmetry into your data. And so this will make your machine learning much more efficient. And as for, so, for the ChatGPT, I also believe that you should treat that as your friends, as your teacher, or as your students, and so you can debate, you can discuss, and you can argue. And so in this way, so you help the machine learning to get improved, and in the same way, you improve your self-knowledge. It's really important to debate with treat it as a friend, and so this is very important.
Yeah, thank you. So, Donghui?
Yeah. So, actually, the machine learning is very powerful, right? Like the algorithm used in ChatGPT, right? Actually, a friend of mine in the USTC, Yang Jinglong, they actually used the Augustine algorithm similar to the ChatGPT, can solve the like a full CI, the electronic structure, right? Very efficient, right? So this is actually I think it's machine learning, okay, just like to us, we have a lot of problem with the computation will increase exponentially, right, with degree of freedom, or electronics, like, or the nuclear motions, right? But the neural network, right, or machine learning can, okay, the scale down from exponential to polynomial, right? So the can reduce the computation dramatically, right, incredibly, you can say. So the right now it's very very popular, right? People just use the machine learning to solve Schrödinger equation for nuclear motion, right? So eventually, I hope we can also use the machine learning to the not just for the data training, right? To solve this the fundamental equations like the Schrödinger equation or the Maxwell equation, everything, okay? Right? Then based on machine learning, the solver, right? We can generate a very highly accurate result for big systems. Then, okay, again, we use machine learning to train this some potential surface or whatever, right? So then, step by step, we can move forward, right?
So thank you. I totally agree. We still have to need the fundamentals, right? Yeah. The foundation of science. Otherwise, we won't be able to differentiate what is true and what is wrong, right? So as you mentioned, they make mistakes. So you are not able to even sort of distinguish the mistakes, so you really need to have the fundamentals of science as a very solid background, right? So, Michael, you want to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to say I had the thought that basically in the interaction with humans and AI, I think right now humans are going to learn from AI a lot faster than AI is going to learn from humans. Mm-hmm. And I almost feel like saying that if we had widespread adoption, every cell phone basically had some of the best large language models in it, it would probably increase the IQ of every single human being on Earth by 50%. Yeah. Now, just imagine what that means for the future. And you can imagine bad things. I mean, you can actually argue that bad things happened in the past, that greater scientific discoveries led to bad things. But, you know, if somebody said you have the choice right now to give a pill that reduces our IQs by 50%, or have a smart device that increases our IQ by 50%, I think it's going to be an amazing future, provided we can control some of our baser instincts. But I don't, basically the last 300 years have been one of enormous progress in civilization and society, with some bad situations, but still. So I think that this is I really do encourage everyone just to play. Ask it the silliest questions. Ask what I should dress today, what I should wear. It is quite amazing that you can get sensible answers to the stupidest questions in the world. and it's really surprising. So play with it, just play with it.
Yeah, I totally agree. And I think it's really a tool and also our friend to help us to expand our horizon.
Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. So since we have still some time, maybe I will open up also. We want to be more interactive with the audience here. So if anyone have want to ask questions, please feel free to do so. Yes, please. Can we have the microphone over there? Yeah.
Thank you. It's all very illuminating and great talks. My name is Xiao Guo from actually Hong Kong Chemistry. My question is this, actually follow on from the panel's discussion on the various advanced tools, methodologies we use to explore the chemical space. Now, even given, let's say, machine learning and the methodology we use, they are still fall within the knowledge sphere. Yeah, the chemical sphere we have. Clearly, for the future of science, we want to push the frontiers, the spheres. So I guess the question, when would it be, what are the efficient tools or beings, if you think of intelligence as well, as a part of one of the beings, that can really push the frontiers of our chemical space? So not only the accuracy and efficiency are the ones we do within, but how do we go beyond? Okay, thank you.
Let me try to answer that the way I'm thinking about it and my friends are thinking about it. My collaborators and I just finished the Madness project, right? And other people have finished projects like this. I think 2023, maybe 2024 will be the years where we show that molecules can AI can dream and make molecules in controlled chemical spaces that we know. As you said, set a playground and optimize within that playground. But there are, some pioneering papers by, for example, Macmillan got the Nobel Prize for his experimental serendipity robotic experiment, right? He was exploring photocatalysts and found some good ones. Sometimes I think there's a Mexican saying like a donkey that played a flute, because I don't believe that necessarily just by randomly doing experiments you get something good. In this case, that's what he did. But if we guide with computational creativity, computational serendipity, which are actually, this is funny, there's actually, I have a paper on computational creativity. I took that concept from the computer scientists, applied it to molecular design. Turns out there is a mathematical formula that people call creativity. Obviously, it's not the same as what we call creativity, but I think that's the next frontier. The next frontier is gonna be when the model is doing those type of explorations. And then the final barrier is a paper I mentioned, making the computer really understand. And I believe for the computer to understand, which is a controversial thing if large language models understand, or they're what is called stochastic parrots, right? They just ingested all the information from humanity and they statistically tell you what they're thinking. Some people think they are thinking. Now, we have to solve that problem first, but I believe there's gonna be new models that actually will be more formal thinkers and will be able to actually understand what you're telling you in a higher level than we have already, which is very impressive. And there, I think, watch out, because there will be robot scientists that will be working with us. And therefore, we will have to learn how to interact with those entities. How long is this going to happen? I don't know. Things are moving really fast.
Yeah. So because of time, I think we have to end the section here. And really, thank you very much for very insightful sort of advices and discussion. And we really look forward for the next few years. Within 5 to 10 years, probably we'll be able to see all these new changes implemented. So with that, thank you very much again. Thank you.
Thank you so much. May I invite you all step forward to have a group photo together? Yeah, we can have a group photo together. First, let's get ready and then have a look to the center. We can have one little step to the right. Yes, don't forget your big smile. One more to go in the middle. And then, keep still. Few more to go, and then one more in the middle of the room. Can we have one more photo together? Let's have a look to the center. Let's have a look to the center to have one more photo. Thank you so much for the insightful sharing. Thank you very much. So this is the finale of this session. We're about to have lunch. You can follow our signage to the restaurant Happiness Cuisine at Building 1W. We will see you again at 1:30. We are going to have different keynote speakers with different insightful topics. See you again 1:30. Thank you.